All right. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Now's a great time to take your seat. There are still some seats up front for those of you standing in the back. I knew it was a fascinating day yesterday. I see a lot of tired faces, so I think a lot of people are at their maximum cognitive capacity. Now, the one thing I failed to mention yesterday, and kind of a critical piece of information, when we're at a conference talking about wildfire, is how we'd actually leave this building in the case of an emergency. So, made it to the first day, fortunately, but we're gonna catch up on the second. So, the location we'll all move to, in case we need to evacuate this building, is the east grassy area. So there's exits immediately to your rear, and as you exit out the rear, you can move to your right, you'll see the grassy field. Or if you're in this area, if you move through these exit doors, and you'll go through two sets of doors, and you'll be right there in that big open area. All right, so this morning, I have the privilege of introducing someone who really needs no introduction to anyone who's been part of the public safety apparatus for the last decade. Craig Fugate was the former FEMA administrator from 2009 to 2017, and is the Florida director for the Emergency Management Division. He oversaw the Big Four of 04, and then is the administrator for the Federal Emergency Management Agency. He organized recovery efforts for a record 87 disasters in 2011. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Craig Fugate to the speaker's dais.
Good morning. Yeah, I do a lot of hurricanes, and people go, so why do we have a guy talking about hurricanes at a wildland fire conference? Well, let's go back to 1998. I was brand new at the Florida Division of Emergency Management. I was the Bureau Chief for Response and Recovery. Starting around Christmas, El Nino was kicking our butt between tornadoes and flooding, but something interesting happened in March. It stopped raining. And it's not unusual. That is our dry season in Florida. But what was a little bit different this time was we started having low humidity. And I realized low humidity is a relative term to you guys. For us, it's anything under about 50%. And we started seeing persistent days of low humidity, high temperatures, windy conditions. And so those of you that deal with the WUI understand that, and that's the wildland urban interface. We didn't even know what the hell that was in 1998. Started drying out, light fuels first, and we started getting brush fires, not unusual in Florida. But as the heavier fuels got drier, the fires became more erratic. To about the middle of June, out of the 67 Florida counties, over 50 of them were declared by FEMA under wildland fire situation. We actually got a major presidential that got so bad. And what was interesting was we were so strapped for resources on the East Coast, Western firefighters were coming to Florida. And the first thing they said when they got off the plane is, how come it's burning? Everything's green. And I'm like, welcome to Florida. We have tiki bushes. We have waxy crepe myrtle. Our ecosystem's designed to burn. And the fires got so complex and got so big, it broke the system. Florida's last really big fire season was in 1985. And the Florida Division of Forestry had learned a lot of lessons from that. Part of that was getting more equipment out to the rural fire departments for initial attack suppression. Part of it was adopting the incident command system, doing a lot more training. And they had worked very well until 1998. 1998, the wildfires were so bad, we ran out of stuff. We ran out of fire trucks. We were actually mission assigning FEMA to bring in fire suppression equipment from the West Coast on aircraft, because you couldn't buy it, find it, lease it, get it. It was one of the largest deployments of the Emergency Management Assistance Compact early in its creation after Hurricane Andrew. We had entire units coming down from states like Virginia, and almost all of these units coming down were not the normal wildland suppression red carded teams. These were volunteer fire departments loaded up brush trucks on trains, came south, and in some cases were doing the initial attack on wildfires. But it was also about the time we started seeing tools like GIS come into play. And because the wildfires were so large and so massive, and the idea of trying to contain these fires in the urban areas, we kept running into a situation where we get the fires contained, we thought it had it control, then the winds would pick up, and all of a sudden, the fires would break out again. We had no earthly idea what was going on until we started getting some initial data. Our first attempt at this was through FEMA was national technical means, basically the recon satellites. And I learned a term I'd never heard before. It's called a derived product. Because in the intelligence community, they could not give us the outlines of the infrared products because they were such high resolution that it would disclose sources. So they gave us an ArcGIS layer of the actual fire outlines. And for the first time, we realized why we couldn't contain these fires. The fires were not burning uniformly like they do in the West. There were actually fires that were like fingers running through these areas burning, and we had large areas that hadn't burned. And the reason we couldn't tell it was there was so much smoke, you couldn't even go in there and see it. But the infrared gave us, for the first time, a true indication of what our problems was, and it changed what we were doing. Because we now realized we had large unburnt fuel in these fire zones that we thought had all burnt out, and they were going to continue until it rained, be sources of threats. And these, again, were in areas like Daytona Beach, just outside of Orlando. Disney had more smoke than it ever had before. It was impacting a lot of our communities. And across the state, again, out of 67 counties, about the only thing that wasn't burning was their beaches. So it was our first real attempt of using technology. The second thing that started to happen was we got into our rainy season. And at this point, most of our efforts had been focused on we got to hit the big fires. And we'll get to the incipient fires when we can, until it started lightning. Lightning strikes were coming down about 1,000 lightning strikes a day. We were seeing up to 100 new starts a day. We quickly realized the math wasn't going to work in our favor. If we didn't do the incipient attacks, we'd get behind, we'd never get caught up. So we had to make a decision to now start shifting resources from the suppression activities around these large complex that we were dealing with in the fires, and put a lot of our aviation assets into initial attack. But where do you start? Like many states, by 1998, Florida had begun pulling people out of the towers. We no longer had the fire spotters. Budget cuts had hit, and we were now back to, how do we even know where to go look? You can put spotter aircraft up, but if you don't know where lightning's hit, what are you looking for? You're looking for that wisp of smoke that may not be visible unless you're right on top of it. But this is about the same time we started seeing the lightning networks starting to get good maps of where we had ground strikes. And so using GIS again, we could look at where we were getting the ground strikes, we could look at the fuel conditions, the type of material there, and make some decisions about prioritizing where we were putting the aircraft and where we were prepared to do incipient attacks, and we could start moving resources. And ultimately, it rained and we got caught up. But it started showing us that the old method of waiting till the fires got reported, waiting until it had gotten that bad to start putting the resources and calling for mutual aid, wasn't working. We needed to start looking at how we could use technology. And Florida went through about a 3-year drought. So by 99, we were actually getting much better at this. And by 2000, we'd actually seen a fairly significant reduction in homes lost, even though we were burning about as much acreage as we did in 1998. So fast forward, by the time I get to FEMA, and again, GIS is now becoming a very useful tool in mapping, looking at risk, and looking at hazards. But the wildfire situation has continued to evolve across the nation. If you look at the two climate signals, the last assessment has really pointed out that are the two clearest indicators. It is going to be increasing intense rainfall events, which we just saw across the Midwest. You guys have been experiencing it. And then we're going through equally intense periods of drought, with the first real symptom of wildfires. And I think what a lot of people have always made the assumption of is that wildfires are a West Coast problem. Nah, y'all just have more droughts. But as the East Coast sees more droughts, we actually have a bigger interface problem on the East Coast. So this is something as a nation we're having to grapple with. As we go into what many people are describing as things are changing, it isn't what it used to be. There's no longer defined wildfire seasons pretty much in California. It's a drought season. We're now seeing, even up to Alaska, the wildfire season has extended by weeks on both ends. Now it's months on both ends. We saw in Pigeon Forge in Tennessee several years ago that, again, in drought situations, fires can rapidly move through and burn homes down in areas that we don't have a wildfire problem. We have our routine stuff. And what I've really started to get to is I think we have normalized how we approach and deal with wildfires to the point where we're really good at treating them almost like emergencies. Even the big complex fires, we have a system that works till it stops working. A couple years ago, I was back out here, it was towards the end of the administration, and we started to see something that we had only seen occasionally, but now we're starting to see back to back, and that is wildfires that are becoming so explosive so fast that, as Cal Fire says, if we're banging on your doors telling you to evacuate, that's a sign. Because if we can't fight the fire, then we're in a whole new ballgame. And we're increasingly seeing now, we're having to make the shift. And it's something we faced in Florida as well. We're having to make the shift from suppression in many cases to putting resources just to evacuate. That life safety and evacuation is now one of the highest priorities we have in some of these fires because they are so erratic and we have built so many people into the interface that the idea that we're just gonna be able to address this by increasing and improving suppression short-term isn't gonna work. We need to have better tools and information about mapping out where the vulnerabilities are. And this is, I think, when Governor Newsom was talking about bringing in technology and looking at the innovations and looking at the loss of life is, what are we going to do differently? How do we better identify the communities at the greatest risk? What does it take to evacuate them? How much time does it take? And then given the current tools and technology, are we even able to begin projecting out how we would know when a wildfire is starting where the evacuation risks are increasing? That's some of the stuff we do at One Concern. You heard that yesterday. But I think it's this question of what are you prepared to do differently with new information? Otherwise, it's just more noise. And I think we're seeing this big shift now that historically, wildland firefighting and the interface was pretty much things that we had very good tools on, we understood, we were working. But the last couple of years, we're seeing both on the East Coast and West Coast. We now have so many people in interface areas that are so vulnerable that when we get these fires that are so erratic, they're spotting miles in advance. We had this, you would think an interstate would be a fairly decent fire break. In 1998, it didn't even slow down. We had spotting on both sides of the, we have to plow down pretty deep to mineral soil when we're dealing with wildfires. We put as many as 12 tractors out there plowing. The fires just spot right over it. And I think that's really what we're starting to see now is, can we use technology? One, to map the risk and hazards now, to know who's the most vulnerable communities. Start that planning of how would we evacuate them? Where are they gonna go? And it's not like hurricanes or stuff where we know it's always gonna be from the coast inland. The fires can be coming from different directions. But as we start looking at our interface, where are people living? If we have to evacuate, how much time does it take? It means communities that have probably never ever done very in-depth evacuation planning are now gonna have to build that into their toolkits. And that's gonna require a lot of other tools such as traffic models, population behavioral data, how to warn them, and more importantly, how do we tell them the safe route to go? In many cases, when we're dealing with erratic fires that are changing behavior so quickly that what was a safe route this morning may not be a safe route by midday. Again, happened to us in Florida. We actually, in 1998, evacuated a county for wildfires. That had never happened in Florida for anything other than hurricanes. But Flagler County was actually caught with three major wildfires, and the concern from the U.S. Forest Service and Florida Division of Forestry was they were probably looking at the first time a real threat of a conflagration in Florida as these fires came together. And so they made a decision to evacuate, or they said, we need to evacuate. And evacuating about 40,000 people, well, in Florida, that was actually something we were pretty comfortable doing. We'd done hurricanes, so we're going to run them up the interstate to Jacksonville. Flagler County sits just south of there. Jacksonville had a lot of shelters, had a lot of capacity. I talked to the director up there, Chip Patterson. Said, no problem, Craig, we'll get the shelters open. We'll be ready. And the fire jumped out 95 and cut our route off. And we had to move them south and west. And we had to do that on the fly. And again, this is what we were seeing as far back as 1998. Large fires, very erratic behavior. And now the number one thing we were challenged with wasn't fire suppression anymore or containment or managing it. It was evacuation of large populations. So where are these homes at? Where would they go? How much time do we have? And have we developed the kind of plans to support that? And then how do we take the dynamics of as we started, again, looking in Florida, if I wait till I have a fire, it's a little bit late to do anything. So when am I hitting conditions, both from my fuel, but from my weather? And I learned early on, just because the National Weather Service has issued a red flag warning does not necessarily correspond to it's going to be a bad fire day. There's a lot of factors that have to go into that. But instead of looking at these as all distinct pieces, how do we start welding it together in a way that we have a better idea of what parts of our community are now facing the greatest threats, that if we do have a fire breakout, they're the ones that are most likely having the time frames to fuel and what's going on that day, the least amount of time to evacuate. And it's always a question of, when do we go from monitoring the event to spending money? It's real easy to say we're going to do stuff, but when do you get to the tipping point before you have a fire that you're really prepared to spend money? Because that's what you're really talking about. If it was free, you'd do it and wouldn't even think twice about it. But moving equipment, notifying people, starting to get shelters on standby, all this starts taking time and resources. But are we getting to the point where our information is getting good enough that we can start making decisions that once we hit certain triggers, we now need to start doing something different to get ready for that? And then in the response, looking at all the different pieces of information coming in, are we going to continue to do what we have traditionally done in our suppression efforts, or are we prepared to do something different? Do we recognize when we have to shift our tactics quick enough? And again, this tends to be, coming at this essentially at the policy level, is always this question of, if it's working, then what are we here? If it's not working, what are we prepared to do differently, and what does it take? And what information and what pieces of data will help that? And so the last piece of this was more of an observation. How many of you are what I consider traditional wildland firefighters, or that's your profession? How many of you are structural guys? You know, I learned a long time ago, I was a volunteer, so we did both of them. But I found out in Florida the difference between a wildland firefighter and a structural firefighter. In a major wildfire, firefighters will go out, structural guys, and they'll try to put out the trees. And a house fire, a structural wildland firefighter will plow a line around the house and say it's contained. So not only do we have, in some cases in the WUI, the whole challenge, in California you get more practice about anywhere else, but how do we merge the structural and wildland firefighters in the one team, particularly in areas that haven't seen these fires? Think about on the East Coast, your practitioners out there, and you probably have a lot of the wildland guys because they love your fire season. They make lots of overtime coming out here and deploying out here as resources, right? So there's been a lot of eastern wildland firefighters that come out here to the West Coast during your fire seasons. As we saw in 1998, when you bring the West Coast firefighters to the East Coast, the coastal plain's a whole different ball game. You know, one thing they found out was we have alligators. Think about your safety brief. I mean, when did you go down to 209, get down to your safety brief, and you got rattlesnakes, water moccasins, alligators, plus the mosquitoes, the noceums, and the black and yellow biting flies, not to mention the high humidity? I got calls from the governor's office of budget going, why did you guys just order 2 pallet loads of cornstarch? It's like, they're chafing. What do you mean they're chafing? It's humid out there. They're wearing gear. And as we went through that, it really pointed out, fire itself is pretty much going to be the same everywhere. But what's burning, how it's burning, the terrain, the structures, how they're built, their vulnerabilities, that's all different. And the fact is, increasingly, it's not going to be structural and wildland firefighters coming to the West Coast. You may be going to the East Coast. It's how do we build systems that can address what we know and deal with all the time to the things we haven't faced before? Because that's, to me, has always been the biggest challenge, is this idea that I can build and normalize and almost take these, what we're called a lot of times, the media called disasters, and go, they're essentially emergencies. The org chart of the organization, the way we're set up, what we're doing, it's really a logistics problem. We're not fundamentally having to do anything differently. And then what happens when we get to the point where that no longer works? The coping mechanisms are breaking. We're having to do something different. And can technology get us there? But my last point, until we have the drones that can launch on the dissection of an incipient fire carrying enough fire suppression to go put the fire out, information doesn't put the fire out, people do. So we always have to keep in mind that if we're really going to talk about building resilient communities, we've got what we call the built environment. It's already a sunk cost and it won't change dramatically. But if we keep building the way we've been building, there's not enough of you. And I don't care how much technology we apply to the problem. If we don't change how and where we build in the WUI, we're going to burn more homes down, we're going to lose more lives, and we're going to put more of your folks at harm's way trying to save those homes. We've got the built environment, and we're going to have to deal with the challenges of that. But as a last step, we have got to continue to educate local officials, builders, and developers that this isn't about not building, but it is about the materials you're using, how you're building your communities, and making sure they're resilient, that when fires happen, we don't lose every damn house. That the infrastructure that we depend on to fight the fires doesn't get burnt out and we lose all our calm. That power systems and other things that are required both to deal with the immediate response but also the immediate recovery are not lost for extensive periods of time. How we build our communities has more impact on the future than anything we're talking about here. What we're dealing with here is what's already built that we're having to do extraordinary things to protect. But we should be thinking long term. How do we build communities that aren't going to burn down in the next wildland fire? There may be some damages, there'll be impacts, but there's no reason why we should continue to lose entire communities in wildfires if we are building them the right way. And this is not rocket science. This isn't even new information. We already know how to do it. In many cases, it's the will to do it, to change. And this comes back to, as much as we spend on suppression, as much as we're talking about all the technology here to look at what we can do to respond better, more efficiently, reduce the loss of life, reduce the loss of homes, if we keep building the problem, we'll never get caught up. So thanks very much. Have a good conference.
Right, our next speaker is Manuel "Manny" Miranda, Vice President of Power Delivery for Florida Power and Light Company. He's responsible for the planning, engineering, construction, maintenance, and operations of the company's transmission, substation, and distribution facilities. Prior to his current role, Mr. Miranda served as Vice President of Transmission and Substation, and before that as Vice President of Distribution System Performance, where he's responsible for Florida Power and Light's Storm Secure initiative to substantially strengthen the distribution infrastructure against future hurricanes. He joined FPL in 1982 and holds a Bachelor's of Science degree in Mechanical Engineering from the University of Miami and an MBA from Nova Southeastern University. Manny?
Good morning, everyone. So we have two back-to-back Florida speakers. Hi, Bill. So this morning, I want to thank you all in advance and humbled to be here and share the FPO journey. It's really been a long journey. But as all of you can tell, I am very short, so I'm going to step outside of this podium for a little while. So I want to share very quickly a little bit about who we are and our story and the parallels between hurricanes and some of the things that we had to do to change our infrastructure, whether it was our technology, our specifications, our processes, all the things we had to do to become more resilient against the impacts of hurricanes, but more importantly, our efforts to predict, to get ahead of failures, to get ahead of things that were about to cause an interruption, or in your case, maybe cause a spark that might cause a fire. So let me tell you a little bit about FPL. Our parent company is NextEra. NextEra has three basic subsidiaries. NextEra Energy Resources. We have significant investments here in California, over $6 billion of investments, whether it's wind, solar, transmission facilities that we have in the state of California. We also have Gulf Power that we just recently acquired, and of course, Florida Power and Light, which is one of the largest utilities in the nation. So let me tell you a little quickly about what FPL is. We serve about half the state of Florida. We serve about 5 million customers, mostly residential customers. We have 1.2 million poles in our service territory, and that becomes very important a little bit later on. 75,000 miles of wire, and we serve 27,000 square miles. So you can see by the map, we serve about half the state of Florida. But one important statistic that's up there is about 80% of our customers, 80% are within 20 miles of the coastline. That means when a hurricane comes, our customers are going to be impacted. And like California, we have our challenges in our service territory. So thunderstorms and lightning. As all of you know, Florida is the lightning capital, only second to one other place in the world. And we have lots of lightning strikes. Just in FPL service territory last year, we experienced 440,000 lightning strikes. And lightning, as you know, is very impactful to the electric grid. And I'm going to share with you all the steps we've taken to mitigate the impact of that. Tree growth, just like here in California, you know, we have lots of trees, lots of palm trees that get into our power lines, and we have to do extensive trimming. Probability of hurricanes, as Bill shared with you, you know, every year we have a 50% chance of getting struck by a hurricane. I've been doing hurricane restoration for a long time. You know, I've been with FPL, this is my 37th year at Florida Power and Light, and I've restored every hurricane since Hurricane Andrew. So it's real, and it has a real impact with our customers. Salt spray, being so close to the shoreline, we have lots of impact from salt spray, again, requiring us to build a little bit different infrastructure. And population growth, we are still experiencing extensive amount of new customers in our service territory. This year, we're expected to connect about 70,000 new homes and businesses. And as Bill was sharing, you know, our growth is going out into the more rural areas, but also we're starting to see customer growth that's going up. Just a couple months ago, we energized an 85-story building. Now, the guy that bought the penthouse, I'm not sure if he's going to run, ride out a hurricane on the 85th floor, because those buildings sway a lot during hurricanes. So we're starting to see more and more of that. We also have the largest mall in the world being built. It's called the American Dream Mall. It'll be larger than the mall in Minnesota, be the larger than the mall in Dubai. It'll have indoor skiing, so you no longer need to come out to California and go to Tahoe or anything. You can come to Florida in the middle of summer, and we love making snow in summer in Florida. I mean, it's great for loads, it's great for our revenues. It's just wonderful. This mall will serve 15,000, will have 15,000 employees. But here's the thing. It's being built in an area that's way out, you know, west for us, and also will add to the congestion of the area already. So again, we're having to deal with more infrastructure, transportation issues, and how to respond to the events. So a little bit about us is our journey, because you know, what you're facing a lot here in California, of course, is the immediate. But we face the immediate, and we've been on a journey for over 20 years. And it really started in 1997, where we started focusing on reliability. And we kicked off an initiative called Reliability 2000 to really improve the reliability we're providing to our customers. And I'll get into more detail in each one of these. Then in 2006, we had to respond to the hurricanes of 2004 and 2005. So we wanted to strengthen the grid. Then in 2010, we began to modernize the grid by implementing our smart meters. Then in 2014, we started dealing with new customer issues, momentaries or these brief outages that are just seconds or cycles, were creating havoc for our customers. So we started a big effort to improve the momentaries our customers are experiencing, and then Grid 2020, and of course, working today on the grid of the future. So in 1997, we took a very practical approach. We said we want to prevent outages from occurring. I mean that's like the big duh, right? I mean, that's everyone wants to do that. But if an outage happens, how do you mitigate it? And then if you can't mitigate it, how do you restore? So as I shared with you on prevent, we went back and started looking at what were we doing in our design And we came up what we call was a really kind of the standard circuit design. So we went back and increased our insulators to be able to better withstand the impact of lightning and these thunderstorms that we were having. We changed the way that we set up our relays in our system. We took a look at every one of our specs and revised our specs to be able to withstand the impact of the characteristics of our service territory. Now, again, we couldn't do it overnight, but that was we had a foundation by which we went forward. But if an outage happened, let's say a car hit a pole, how do you minimize the impact of that? And we started to invest and work with a company called S&C, and I'll share a little bit more of their story, to install these interrupters to be able to self-heal the grid, isolate the location of the event, and then restore quicker. So effectively, we could restore 50, 60% of the customers within a minute automatically, and then it narrowed where our problem was at, and we began to restore a lot quicker. And then our restoration put a lot of time and effort on our coverage, where our crews were located. We've worked very, very closely with the police and fire departments also, because what we started realizing too is there's many times police and fire departments who are arriving at site needed facilities to be de-energized, and we didn't have a good standardized process. So we put really meticulous process by which if a policeman or a fireman arrive on site, let's say a car hit a pole or there's a structural fire and they needed to de-energize the grid, we can do it remotely for them to be able to begin their response. So we worked very, very closely with the police and fire departments, and it really began our bond that really helped us during the 04 and 05 hurricane season, which is here. So in 2004, 2005, we were kind of cruising along with reliability 2000, really improving our reliability to our customers. But we got hit with 7 hurricanes in an 18-month period. Think about that. I mean, we were one storm after another. And we also went and responded to a couple other hurricanes that had hit in Texas during this time frame. But here was the big thing about this 04 and 05 season. We got hit with Hurricane Charlie. We thought we did a great job. And then, you know, we kept getting hit with storm and storm. But it culminated with a storm called Hurricane Wilma. Hurricane Wilma was the last of these hurricanes. It was the strongest of these hurricanes. And it took us 18 days to restore. And I will tell you personally that that was our very best operation response, because hell, we already had 6 other practices, right? We already knew where the staging sites were, where to fuel, where to put our materials. We knew operationally everything that was required. But we brought in extensive forensics, hired external views, put our own teams together. And here was the big change. For the first time, wind only exceeded and was the main cause of our poles that were broken. So basically, our design wasn't sufficient to handle the intensity of that storm. So we had to regroup. And we had to regroup quickly because a couple things were happening. Our customers were livid with us. They were upset. Our regulators were upset. They were under tremendous pressure. Political leaders were under pressure. Media, you name it, everybody was under political pressure to do something different. As well as our employees. Our employees were exhausted. And business continuity had gone away. We weren't doing our regular jobs anymore. It was storm duty all the time. And it was impacting the way we operate our business. So we came out with an initiative called Storm Secure. And when we came out with this, I will tell you, it rattled the industry. You know, because this term of hardening, resiliency did not even exist in our vocabulary in some of this time frame. So we rolled out a hardening initiative, which was to strengthen the grid. And so here's the big aha with that. You know, the electric industry builds effectively to 2 standards, under the National Electric Safety Code. Grade C construction, which is the minimum construction you build to, and grade B. Very simple, very simple. FPL, because of his history with hurricanes, always built to grade B. It's about 100 mile an hour wind criteria. There's also one other standard where big transmission lines are built to, which is the NESC Extreme Wind Grade B. Interestingly enough, in Florida, when you apply it, It's anchored on the Florida Building Code. And the Florida Building Code was revised after Hurricane Andrew in 1992, as Bill was sharing, to make homes more resilient. Whether it was a new home being built, you had to build, you know, to withstand the winds, and or you were encouraged to go back and install storm shutters, tie your roof down, take actions to mitigate the amount of damage. So that extreme wind design was 145 mile an hour winds. So we went back and said, you know what? We're going to anchor on that South Florida, on the Florida Building Code, because, you know, the reality is, if our pole, if all the homes get blown away, it's not going to matter a whole lot what stays up, right? We've got to anchor on something. So we anchor to the Florida Building Code, and today we're going back and hardening our main feeder lines to 145 mile an hour winds. So it's making it much more resilient. Pole inspections, inspecting all our poles every 8 years. But more importantly, if we see an immediate hazard on a pole, we repair it, we call a trouble office and get it repaired immediately. And or if there's something that is imminent failure in the next 30 days, we'll do it. If not, we'll do it in the next calendar year. I will tell you, we are completely disciplined in that process. I was not in favor of a pole inspection program because historically we had not seen pole failures. But what we found is almost a 10% pole failure on our first cycle. We replaced over 100,000 poles in our first pole inspection program. It was really an eye-opener. But the more important thing is, when you find it, you've got to repair it. Increase our vegetation management. And then finally, overhead underground conversions. We started to see that underground did extremely well during hurricanes. Extremely well. So we did an analysis and encouraged our customers to convert to underground. So today, we actually will pay customers a 25% incentive to convert facilities to underground. And this has also been very instrumental in getting customers to begin changing. This is how we rolled out in 06, and in a few minutes I'll share with you the lessons we learned after the recent hurricane we experienced. So here's kind of where we sit today as far as our hardening efforts. Today, before the 04 and 05 season, we're 13% either underground or hardened. Today, we are at 47%, inspected all our poles. We're in our second cycle of pole inspection, increased our tree trimming. We've had 38,000 customers take advantage of the incentive, the 25% incentive. This is for large communities. Flood monitors, you know, this is a humbling business. This is an area we did not have or come from us. This is really a lesson learned from Superstorm Sandy in the Northeast, where floods really became a big issue. So we developed flood monitors. We went and looked at all our substations that had exposure to flooding, which could potentially put our equipment underwater and jeopardize our protective schemes that can result in some significant failures in the field or not be able to clear something that's happened in the field, can make something catastrophic. So we developed a flood monitoring system equivalent to what you're doing with your fire monitoring. We do it for floods. We watch the water levels at certain points in a substation, and we will proactively de-energize during a hurricane as a storm surge is coming in if it triggers our flood monitors. During the last storm, Hurricane Irma, we de-energized two substations where the water triggered the first alarm and then triggered the second alarm within that substation. And we had never done that in the history of our company before, proactively de-energize customers in that fashion. We also made a decision to strengthen our transmission grid. We're removing every single wood structure out of our grid. So today, 92% of our transmission infrastructure is either steel or concrete. And that played huge dividends in our ability to restore after Hurricane Irma. And then putting more and more and more intelligent devices, such as intelliruptors, on our grid. So here is the results of our efforts. So our last major storm was Hurricane Irma. Roughly the size of Texas, the thing was a monster. Moved very, very slowly. It took 24 hours to clear our grid. So we had to respond to this. So here was the results. Impacted 4.4 million customers. Poles damaged. You can see we went from Hurricane Wilma. And by the way, Hurricane Irma statistically was about a 50% stronger storm than Hurricane Wilma. It completely covered our entire service territory, but we only saw 4,600 poles come down versus 12,000 during Wilma. Our substations, it took us 5 days during Wilma to restore our transmission grid. In less than a day, we had every single substation in our service territory energized, ready to restore customers. And Irma only took us 10 days versus 18, and you can see the average time was 2.3 days. So the average customers were out from 5 days to two. Here's the interesting thing. The economic impact to the communities is enormous. Just the economic impact in FPL service territory is equivalent to about $1 billion per day. That means every day that the state of Florida is out of power in FPL's territory is $1 billion. Just that alone almost paid for our entire investment for our communities on the economic impact it had. But we learn, just like every storm we learn we have to keep doing better communicating with our customers. So we're continuing to improve our social media, our apps, our ability to get ahead and provide customers information they need to be able to plan their lives. And for those who have evacuated, when they can return, when can they expect to return. Right tree, right place. 90% of the outages that happened during Hurricane Irma were because of trees. Not because of trees that we lacked trimming, because we were completely on the maintenance cycles. There were trees outside of our right-of-way trimming. Trees that toppled over during the hurricane onto our power lines. So we are really stressing and reinforcing and promoting the right tree, right place concept, really working closely with county leaders to encourage customers to remove some of those trees. But because of that, we're also going to do a pilot and undergrounding. Then our hardening feeders did extremely well, extremely well. So we're going to continue on that path. By 2024, every one of our main circuits at FPL will be hardened. And by 2021, all our transmission poles will be steel or concrete. So our grid is coming up to par. Now, what we also learned is the neighborhood lines, because of those trees, there's no way to harden them. There was no way to figure out a way to harden those lines because many of them are in customers' backyards, big trees, right? And you can't stick a 100-foot pole in somebody's backyard. So what we're doing is we're going to pilot undergrounding. It's gotten to the point where our underground cost is becoming very competitive with overhead. And when you start looking at underground with a life cycle cost, you know, you're not doing vegetation trimming, pole inspections. You're not doing a lot of those things you're required to do on the overhead and the exposure you get during restoration or after thunderstorms. Our underground costs are becoming very competitive. So we are now doing a pilot in which we are going to begin to underground neighborhood lines on our cost, on our nickel. And it's a 3-year pilot, it's $100 million. It's going to focus on, you know, those customers that had outages during Hurricane Irma and Matthew prior to it, those customers that have heavy vegetation, as well as those customers who have experienced a lot of outages. These projects will be spread throughout our service territory, and we're going to be piloting different construction techniques. We're going to be piloting different designs. We're going to be looking at alternative ways to keep driving down that cost to be able to make undergrounding, you know, more cost effective. We know it works during hurricanes, and I imagine it works, you know, really well here during, you know, the fires or not causing fires. So it's an area that, you know, we're spending a lot of time and effort on, making sure that we can make this a competitive tool for us as we begin to strengthen our grid. But we're also, in addition to making it more resilient, we're investing significant amount to make our grid smarter and more predictive. So, you know, we deploy 5 million smart meters. You know, we're very effective in our smart meter rollout. And just like everyone else, basically justify the program on less meter readers and disconnect reconnects. That definitely achieved it. But those smart meters have given us tools we never imagined. Deployed over 110,000 intelligent devices on our grid. And we established a diagnostic center. We have a facility that all they're doing is about 10 folks. All they do is effectively look at the data, and they're looking ahead. They're trying to figure out, when is our next failure point? When are we going to experience an outage? And they've come up with some very creative tools and algorithms that are helping us predict outages before they occur. And one of the companies and one of the tools that we have really invested in is with a company called SNC. They're out of Chicago. I think they're located in the, some of them are here. I saw their CEO here, Kyle's here. Three main devices that we use. We call them automated feeder switches. They call them interrupters. Automated lateral switches. They call them trip savers. Automated transformer switches. They call it a vacuum fuse. These devices have helped us significantly either self-heal the grid and or, you know, act as effectively reclosures. There's no more fuses. Effectively, we're eliminating all fuses from our grid so that we won't see, in your case, the sparks. But more importantly, many times we were just going out there and responding to events. There was nothing wrong. It was just a temporary event that caused an outage, and the system self-healed itself. You can see the automated feeder switches. We avoided 1.3 million customer outages with those switches last year. With the lateral switches, we avoided 9,000 truck rolls. Think about that. All that was required was a neighborhood line went out. There was nothing wrong with the line. Maybe a branch touched the line or an animal touched it or a lightning strike, enough to clear itself. And all we had to do was get out there and refuse. And the system self-healed itself, and we avoided 9,000. That's real savings to our customers and better reliability. And now we've pushed it to the edge with transformers. We deployed about 1,000 of these down to the transformer level, again, eliminating these fuses and also looking to self-heal. And again, transformers don't have a big reliability impact, but boy, they're a huge customer dissatisfier, and they're a big operating expense, driving out that cost from our grid. And I know the other big thing with the automated feeder switches is, you know, when those switches operate, they don't use the amount of energy that is required from a traditional reclosure or your distribution breaker to find the fault. And this is an example of, on the left, where traditional, you know, distribution breaker. On the right, the technology that's used by these interrupters, really minimizing the amount of impact, the amount of energy that's required to figure out if you have a fault in your grid or not. We've also invested a lot in putting technology on our devices. So Sentient, which I see they have a table here, also has been a big partner of us where we've been installing their devices on our grid to help us figure out where faults are locating and or start giving a signal that something is about to go wrong in our grid. And we've installed about 24,000 of these. So if you were to look at the FPL grid today, we have automated feeder switches on almost every one of our feeders. Every single one of our neighborhood lines has these automated lateral switches, 80,000 of them. And we have 24,000 of these Sentient products on our grid, giving us technology and information we've never had before. So, and the smart meters. So the smart meters, one of the things we did, had it in place a couple years ago now. You know, those things put out about 300 different messages per hour. We were able to, like some of the utilities have started to do the same, develop an algorithm that looked at a certain profile that gave us a signature when the service drop, the last connection to the house, was about to fail. And so today, we knock on about 25 to 35 customers every morning. We'll knock on the door and say, you're about to have a power outage. And we know that because statistically, we know that within the next 1 to 3 days, with 88% confidence, they're going to have a failure. And if we walk away, like, you know, some customers have asked us, hey, can you come back? They fail. Now, our customers kind of freak out when we tell them they're going to have a power failure. They're like, how do you know that, right? But the smart meters have given us information like never before. So we prevent a lot of these outages. Typically, they fail at the worst time. So now we can do this planned work without a failure on a planned interruption under our time schedule, right, and with the least inconvenience to the customer. It's a win-win-win, and it reduces our operating costs as well. So we figured out the service drops to the house. And oh, by the way, it works on the underground systems too. It's been able to identify when we have a bad connector and a handhole. So we're able to go out and repair connectors and handholes, again, before they even fail. So now we're working on trying to figure out at the primary level. So using all this smart grid data, we're using artificial intelligence, we're using devices, the drones, to help us do image recognition. So now every day we get about 5 feeder alerts that say, something's wrong with these circuits. We don't know what, but you need to go take a look at it. So what we and because of all these technologies we have, we can narrow down where we need to go look at, and with about 90% confidence, we're finding something. And we send a drone team. And the reason we send a drone team is because now the traditional way of looking at it from the bottom up, you don't catch. Look, the reality is a lot of the problems we have are on the top of the pole line or the wire. And now we have narrowed it down, smaller patrol, more effective. And this is an example of the things we're finding. You know, things are pitting. Hasn't failed yet, but we're catching it before it fails. And these are examples of the things that the drone, because it's happening on top of the pole line, you can go right by this a million times while you're driving and never see it. So again, getting ahead of power failures, getting ahead of wires coming down, getting ahead of something creating a fault is really the objective. And I personally believe that is our future as an industry. We've got to predict and get ahead of failures before they occur. That's the journey. So here's the proof for FPL. So here's some statistics. So today, we have 13% less employees. And this is power delivery, not total FPL. This is just the transmission and distribution team. Our safety has improved by 84% during this time period. We've increased our customer base by almost 38%. Our outages have improved by 63%. We're at 54 minutes of safety last year. It's top decile performance in the nation. Momentaries, we've improved by 70%. These are those temporary outages that you see at customers' homes that are very disruptive. Our log complaints, our customers have noticed it. We've gone down 93% improvement in the complaints to the commission, as well as our operating costs have come down. So it's kind of the trifecta, right? It's great reliability, low cost. By the way, for FPL, we not only have the best reliability in the state of Florida, we also have the lowest bill in the state of Florida. And we also take great pride in the customer service level we provide. So that's kind of the journey we've been on, but it's been a journey, you know, whether it's been resiliency or prediction. And I think a lot of these things that we're talking about, investments in technology, process changes, looking at your specs, conducting thorough forensics, can really set you down a path. There's some things that we did immediately, but the reality is you have some things that you can do in the next year. But it is a journey. It's a journey that you will need to take to improve this grid and improve, you know, the fire response that you have here in California. So that's our journey. Thank you.
Our next speaker probably gets the Distance Award, joining us from Australia. Simon Dunstall leads the Decision Sciences Program in CICERO, the Commonwealth Scientific and Industrial Research Organization's Data 61. Data 61's mission is to promote a flourishing national ecosystem of researchers, developers, and innovators in digital technologies and data-driven businesses. The Decision Sciences Program has 100 staff members and a much larger network of collaborators, and has foci including social media analytics, information systems engineering, natural hazard risk modeling, optimization, and finance and super attenuation. Simon is a researcher in analytics and optimization. His research work includes the development of infrastructure network planning systems and the development of methods for quantifying and managing the bushfire-related risks posed by power lines in Australia. In addition to his role at CICERO, Simon is the current national president of the Australian Society for Operations Research, ASOR.
Morning, everyone. Yes, it is a long way to California from Melbourne in Australia, but there's a fair bit that's similar, including the fact that wildfires and power lines are a major problem. So we've had events for the last 60 odd years with wildfires and power lines, but our big event, biggest, was in February 2009, where 162 people lost their lives due to fires caused by power lines on the 7th of February. And that, to a large degree, is the starting point of my experience in this area. My organisation, CSIRO, is a large research organisation in Australia, and one of our very longest established groups is in fire science. They've been around for 60 or 70 years. That includes a guy called MacArthur, who some of you in the fire space might know of. So, I think if I press the green one, it'll move. Yes, okay. So, what's this talk about? First, power lines cause wildfires. That's not a surprise. When I wrote these slides about a week ago, still in Australia, I thought I might need to kind of make people aware of this. What I've found here is that this notion that power lines and wildfires are kind of synonymous, they're only 1 or 2% actually of wildfire starts, but the mood here is, you know, these two things are almost the same. Now, for us, that's similar, although time does change perception. And where I live in Victoria, power lines are only about 2% of fires. We have a lot of dry lightning fires as well. And in most jurisdictions, it's people that are the problem. So we do work in Shelley. Way over 90% of all the fires are human, and quite a lot of that is arson. Anyway, there's this other piece of it that we all kind of feel in the bones and which is very difficult to explain, but the notion that power line initiated wildfires are more likely to be large and lead to fatalities. That's just the history we have. 80% of deaths in Australia since 1950 due to wildfire are from wildfires that started with power lines. And that can be a random effect, but then when we see the same thing happening here, you say, well, there's something going on. Unfortunately, I'll move forward a few slides, but we still don't really know why. Now, there are mitigations for this, and we just saw a great narrative of mitigations around hurricanes. Many of those same mitigations also work for bushfire. Really, the body of this talk is how do we then relate the possible mitigations, like undergrounding, to wildfire likelihood reduction and use that to do spatially targeted investments in a region to reduce that risk as much as possible, subject to a budget. Right, we can't make everything safe. The budget we had was about 2% of the total cost of undergrounding. Okay, so power lines cause wildfires. This is a very mischievous video that never runs, so I'll just leave the still here, but if you type into YouTube Markson, M-A-R-X-S-E-N, you'll get videos that Tony Markson and his team in Victoria, and Tony was the chairman of the Australian Energy Market Operator, but is also a scientist and is very passionate about bushfire initiated power lines, and he set up a lab made out of shipping containers and other things, and that's a 22 kilovolt line with a bit of tree across it, and he did this lots of times with different kinds of vegetation and looking also at the effect of different types of electrical protection. Now, these fires happen, it's not just conductor break. All right, so the classic thing is somehow you end up with a conductor that breaks and that ends up on the ground and it releases an arc. There are many, many other ways that power lines start fires. In Australia, 50% of them are possums and rats and magpies and other birds and animals in a blazing death off a structure or mid-span falling onto grass. So this is a list of many of the failure modes that we see that cause fire, and almost all of them, other than the animals or birds, the likelihoods go up dramatically as the fire danger goes up. The same drivers: wind, lack of humidity, ambient temp. They all drive the rates up. Now, in different places, the percentages are different, but they're all quite small. So we're dealing with a small fraction of all of the wildfires that happen that are electrical. But as I said earlier, Our experience is that these fires have a tendency to be bigger and more fatal. There's a few hypotheses out there. None of them, I've never seen any evidence, and we've tried to build evidence that actually explain it. So I mentioned about 80% of our deaths in Australia since 1950. There are three major events finishing with Black Saturday. On each occasion, there were things put in place. The Wimmera fires in 1977 was conductor clash, so conductors waving in the air and touching each other was one of the main mechanisms. That led to the mounting of spreaders, which is fiberglass rods that hold the conductors apart. Ash Wednesday in 1983 was another major fire event. Most of the electrical fires that caused fatalities were in South Australia. They then put about 1,000 kilometres of cover conductor in, I believe is the figure. I could be quite wrong. I don't live in South Australia. They hardened their assets. They already had the best assets in Australia, but they've got steel poles, basically two pretty much railway rails with concrete in the middle. They're called Stobie poles, and they're very good poles for not breaking and for having a hard network. They also the only state in Australia that actually has the right to de-energise. So the way our system works, the power companies don't actually have the right to turn the power off preemptively, except in South Australia. And Black Saturday I mentioned before. That led to a big spend, and I'll be talking mainly in this talk about how did that big spend get directed. Chile and California, I haven't put the stats. These are things you'll be more familiar with. But it's very clear that there's a problem here too. So why is it? Do statisticians get interested in that little hump there? But that's because they're statisticians and they can't deal with the fact there's only six fires that make that hump. That hump is basically the size of the fire just divided by how long did it take to commence the initial attack for power line initiated fires on the left and for all other ones on the right. And the one on the left, the little humps on the right-hand side there is saying, well, these fires got big even though our response was sort of timely. That's sort of an interpretation. But it's very weak evidence. We did a big data-driven study. We can't explain this. We can't explain why a power line fire is such a problem. For those six fires, there are some similarities between them, and I think the biggest one of interest is that there were multiple electrical faults recorded on the system in about the same time and about the same place of that fire. Now, is that then some kind of localized weather, intense weather event? What is it? But that was one of the telltales, but otherwise there was no real way of explaining it. Now, just as an aside to explain some terminology, in our experience, it's the high voltage lines that cause the fires. It's not the service lines, it's not the low voltage ones. In the main, that doesn't mean that you can't start a bushfire, a wildfire with a low voltage line. They're just not the main target. The sub-transmission and transmission lines, again, they're much less likely to be involved. Our focus has been on the distribution feeders that in where I live, it's 22 kV three phase or 12.7 kV single wire earth return. And so that means we're dealing with feeders coming out of what they call zone substations. Now this is a widespread threat. That's Victoria and that's Australia. And every dot there is a HV power pole and there's 600,000 of them. There's a bit of a colouring here which is based on is it SWIR or is it 22 kV in forest or grassland or something else. But there are a lot of ignition points. If you like, and if you're a firefighter and you wake up on a windy day, there are 600,000 time bombs out there ready to go. And on a bad day for us, on average, six of them go off. That's the rates. This is a seaside place. I'll look for photos. I need a photo of forest. And I found this one, I thought, good, it's got power lines in it too. So each of those red ones is pointing to a HV pole in a coastal community in a place in the Surf Coast in Victoria. And the yellow ones are LV lines. So happy holiday people, nice dry coastal shrub, 22 kV, through the place. Now, we do veg management, of course. We look after these assets just like Manuel does in Florida, but there are 660,000 of these. Mitigations, there are plenty. You can try and deal with your threat, physical barriers to that threat getting into your asset. Birds and animals, 49% of faults. Let's put covers over everything so they don't get there. We can deal with the vulnerability of the assets. So looking after asset condition, putting covered conductor, or put the thing underground. It's not vulnerable anymore. Your last line of defense is what they call electrical protection. And that's the detection piece of something going wrong on the lines. And the faster you pick up a fault, the less energy is emitted into the environment, the more chance that you don't have a wildfire. These are some stills of some more of Tony's videos. There's a particular electrical protection called RAFCOOL that we've adopted in Victoria. It's Rapid Earth Fault Current Limiter. When you don't have RAFCOOL and you go into a lab with some dry grass and a 22 kV conductor on a bit of an apparatus, you get this sort of thing. If you install RAFCOOL and you slow down to one frame, all you've got is that under this broken conductor type experiment. So from an experimental program, we figured out this was actually pretty useful. What we needed to do then was say, well, how useful is this stuff? How many wildfires would you stop if you start rolling this out? We need to, and important in this very early on, the whole system really embraced the notion that this was a quantitative risk problem. What's my likelihood? What's my consequence? I'm going to do mitigation, so I'm going to hit the higher consequences of the higher likelihoods. In fact, I'm going to hit where the product of those two is the highest. In this, we need to also consider what's going on. We have an escalation process from a threat through to a large fire. Some threats operate at the poles, some operate at the spans. So if you're looking at, say, agricultural machinery striking assets, it strikes the span, it doesn't strike the pole. Animals are usually on the structure. Trees hit the span, not the pole. Well, they do hit the pole too. And to do this modeling, we broke this thing down into four parts. We needed to know how the faults developed and how did they change with meteorology. We need to know how faults turn into ignitions. And we didn't deal with ignitions directly because there's not enough in the data set. We had 800 ignitions to work with and a zillion dimensions that mattered. But the other reason we deal in faults is when you change the electrical system, you change its fault behavior, and then the ignitions do or don't happen. So we model the new performance of the electrical system to get the ignitions. We're not dealing with ignitions directly when we look at that mitigation. We then need to say, well, this AI and ML stuff's fantastic. I'm a proponent of this stuff too. It's not very good for systems you don't have yet. You don't have data on a fully undergrounded system. You don't have data on a RAFCOOL system. You can't just grab it, put it in a black box, and get out the relationship. So we needed to model how these faults occur and use more old school mathematical things. And then we do our risk calculations. So these fault rates, we know they depend on many things. They depend on what kind of asset you have. Where is it? What's its situation? Is it in grassland? Is it in forested land? Is it hilly? Is it flat? What kind of line is it? What's the voltage? How many phases? What's the meteorological conditions? Because wind in particular is a big driver. How does that change the faults and ignitions? And then having figured out the consequence, what is the risk performance of that asset? The second bit, oh, I won't do that yet. So I mentioned most of this, there's different causes of these faults. We had 45,000 electrical faults in a data set, classified by what sort of caused the problem, what was the damage done, and a whole lot of free text that really told the story and took us about 3 months to clean and extract the information from. In doing that, we figured out, yeah, animals and birds are the biggest deal. Vegetation, trees within the corridor that are managed by the sort of within where the power company needs to deal with it were about 8% of these faults. Other trees, and we heard in Florida, trees outside of what Manuel could do anything about, were about 1%. And then we've got a problem in this data, and it's always an issue dealing with this. When it's stormy, the patrols just say, oh, it was the weather, right? Which is not that helpful for us. So we don't know that 26% what really happened. They've just put storm. All right, the kind of damage we see, don't pay too much, you know, don't try and memorize the numbers or anything. Again, we have a big proportion of the damage that's sort of put down to other stuff. Now, a lot of that other stuff is the burning bird in its last moments hitting the ground. And there was a transient fault. You may have tripped out, you might have blown the fuse, but there's no damage to the system. So the system ops management says there's no damage. Okay. The other part we need to know is, how do these faults turn into ignitions? Being fiery people, we want it based on fire danger index, and it's a good measure. So we end up looking at, for the different types of ignition, what's their translation rate into a fire as a function of what was the cause and what is the fire danger rating at the time. And that makes sense, because that's telling us about something about the propensity of the fuel to catch. It's a bit of a misuse, because fire danger rating in Australia, at least, is based on forward rate of spread of fire. It's not quite the right concept, but it works for everyone, and we just stick with it. And the main reason is those drivers of faults are the same drivers in the fire danger index anyway. This bit about the modelling, how do we say how a REFCO will perform when we don't have one yet, was effectively quantifying a threat barrier diagram. So we looked at all of the different ways that a fault can be stopped, or a threat on the left-hand side, can be stopped as it progresses to the right-hand side with a fire and then possibly a fatality. So when you put in place an automated circuit recloser that can detect a fault on the network and closes, that's one of the barriers on the diagram. If you put a covered conductor, you've now put a barrier on this diagram. And the thing is, there's a lot of quantities here. There's a lot of splitters, like that big brown box in the middle. We don't have data to observe it. So there was a giant spreadsheet in the middle of this process where some electrical engineers made some fantastic guesses at things like what proportion of vegetation strikes are a phase-to-earth fault, versus a phase-phase earth versus a phase-to-phase. And how many are low impedance, high impedance, or very high impedance? Those guesses are really important, because different electrical protection can see different types of those, but you can't observe it in the real world. And so you bring in some crusty old electrical engineers and see what you can do. So what we can do is come up with some guesses, estimates, depending on which way you look at them, of different mitigations, like putting power lines underground, or putting this REFCO stuff on them, or putting covered conductors or automatic circuit reclosers. What risk reduction do you get? This is a likelihood reduction here. And basically, there are three modes. One is some little things you do that knock out about 10%, some intermediate stuff, which gives you about 50%, and then when you go covered conductor or underground, you get not quite 100. Nothing is 100% risk reduction. You can have a tree fall smack bang on the top of your kiosk in an underground system. So it's not 100% available, but you get pretty close. The much bigger question, in a way, is, okay, we know this, but where do we invest something like $500 million when the total bill of what the Royal Commissioner told you you had to do, put everything underground, will cost you between $40 and $60 billion to do? You've got to target. Now, in some ways, we're lucky, because the variation in likelihood and consequence is dramatic over a state. A way to start this is, we need to know what's the consequence of fire if it started at a particular place. This map's built by every second power pole in the west of the state, each location, running up to 24 fire simulations with different conditions through that point. In the end, 2.1 million fire simulations using our engine called Spark, combined with all these asset options, 20 million data points, that can help us target. The colors on this map, yellow is the consequences high. If a fire starts here, the damage it do will be high. If it's deep purple, not much happens. And included in that, we have to estimate initial attack probabilities as well. So the consequence part, and we saw this yesterday from Technosilver as well. You have a grid or you have points in space, you do a fire simulation from it. You say, ooh, we just burnt some stuff. What did that cost? And then you've got an estimate of the consequence. Now, our aim actually is to stop fatalities. And when we count structures and value, it's a proxy. Not a great proxy, but it's sort of the standard. Now, the other thing we need to do while we do so many simulations is, depending on the conditions, the fire does different things. So we'd be very probabilistic about this. We start at a point, we run an ensemble, we figure out the red here is sort of high probability of impact if the fire happens, blue is low. We build these maps, consider the fact that the meteorology patterns are very spatially specific. These are wind roses in Sydney for a study we did around railway power lines. And you can end up with some very fine-grained information about what's the probability distribution of fire intensity at a point if it starts from a particular point. So the top left is a distribution of low intensity, and the bottom right here is where the highest intensity would be expected from fires from that given starting point. So this is telling us the consequence at a point. The power asset at that point and what we might choose to do to it is telling us the likelihood at that point. And we put those together plus initial attack to give the expected loss. So we might have a likelihood spatial variation that might look like this. The darker blue is lower likelihood and the colorful ones are higher likelihood. This changes in space because of things like the meteorology can be drifting, your expected wind speed to your valleys and stuff, but also longer spans give you a longer exposure when you map it down to a pole. There's a few other reasons too, but you get some variation in the likelihood, you get some big variation in the consequence. So the spatial scale here is about, I don't know, this is Geelong, about 40 miles across. And those colorful ones on the right, they'll burn that photo I showed you before. That photo is in a place called Fairhaven near Anglesey. Those are up near Winchelsea, which is about 50K up. There's a nice big patch of forest between the two of them. Good way to get a good fire, and comes under a north wind. So you end up with a risk variation, and this says, where do I go and put my stuff underground? All right, and that's basically the process. But the other thing is you also get your fire service commissioner in to help you figure out things because this data doesn't do everything. And you can do it, I'm pressing the back button. You can do it on value or you can do it on cost. And you've got to verify this stuff. So this is in Sydney, this is a different project, looking at that variation in risk, looking at the map and say, does this make sense to us? Does this relate to high value assets or places where a fire will run and impact people and structures? So what did we do in Victoria? Like, we've done all this quantification. Let's reinforce that we looked at these assets we don't even have yet. We figured out how many fires they'll start and relative to a bare wire system. We figured out the consequence at the points. We got some money in our pocket. And we have an event that began this, which was Black Saturday, 7th of Feb, 2009, where we had winds that were at least 60 kilometers an hour, top end 80, 100, what about 47 degrees Celsius ambient temp. And this is in like a temperate place, notionally. That was air that had been baked over the center of South of Australia for many weeks. It was preceded by days of 43, as well. So these were temperatures we had actually seen 45 in 1939, but that's 47 is a record for us, and almost no humidity at all, about 5%. And it was a bad day. So we had a fire that was spotting about 30 kilometres ahead. That was a power line fire. During that day, as I said, there was 173 deaths overall and 162 were power line related. So we had what's called a Royal Commission, a large commission of inquiry that works like a court case, chaired by Bernard Teague, ran for 2 years. Out of that came recommendations. One was put all the power lines underground. We also did, not we, I wasn't involved in it, but the state, asked people what were they prepared to pay for wildfire mitigation. They said, oh, about $200 on my power bill every year. So that gave us sort of something about the social trade-off. After the Royal Commission, there was a task force that then put these together, said, what are our options? How do we respond to this? And then that led to a 7-8 year government program that had money in the kitty, $750 million Australian, which at the moment is about 600 or 550 US, to spend on research, on undergrounding and other direct mitigations, on local energy solutions for reliability reinforcement, because we were going to have a network that was going to go off more, and for compensation for low-income earners and others whose power bills would go up. Right. So that led to a few things. One of the main things it led to, actually, which is a side effect that was very important, is because the government put money on the table and said things must happen, it actually told the energy regulators what the trade-off point is between safety and money in the eyes of the state of Victoria. And that's been very helpful to us in an ongoing sense, because it puts a framework in place for making economic and safety trade-off decisions. There was, in the end, $400 million in direct power infrastructure change funded out of this program, and it's what the data analytics drove. So we put power lines underground, both private overhead lines and 22 kV and 12.7 kV distribution lines, about 1,000 kilometres worth, roughly. We also put in this REFCOL stuff. And what's also happened in the areas where we're doing the targeted replacement, any new construction must be underground. So there's defined areas of the state where everything new must go underground or equivalent. And then they did stuff. They put signs out, which is really important for government programs, at least in Australia, it must have signs. And then they actually went and, with these particular areas, took the lines and pulled them down. Right. This is not going up, this is coming down. And there's 33 of these areas where the power lines are ripped out and put underground, as well as the rolling out of this rapid earth fault current limiting technology, which gives you about a 50% likelihood reduction at zone substations, about 45 of them over a 6 year period. They come in three tranches. The first tranche is supposed to have the switches flicked on by April this year. They're struggling a little bit, but they'll get close. And then in April 2021, the next tranche has to be in, and April 2023, the final one. The final one's not funded, the first two are funded. And so this is live, this is really happening. You can go out and you can see this equipment, and it's been in the field for a few years in the early ones. And that was arrived at, basically, before I do that. Really, we took this likelihood and consequence thing, we looked at every zone substation, we calculated the risk before and the risk after, we made a prioritised list, and then they made legislation based on that data. All right. So this was an end-to-end process from the legislators all the way through to the data analysts. And there you go, the different groupings. So this is the western part of Victoria, and you'll see quite a lot of it get covered by REFCOL in the end, in the three different tranches. One of the sticking points with this technology is what it does is if you have a ground fault, it puts that phase at zero, raises the other two from 22 kV to 33 kV. That, I lost all the firefighters in that little bit of explanation especially, but what that means is your high voltage customers' equipment might need to be replaced, and that's a political sticking point because you're saying to factories and shopping centres, you've got to spend millions of dollars that we're not funding you for to change your equipment because it's got to deal with REFCOL being installed. But outside of that little wrinkle, it's a big program covering about half the state by area. That's the wrong direction again. Okay, and this is just to show how this targeting works. This is not like an idealized plot. This is a real plot of 811 feeders in the state. What's its amount of risk? What's its amount of the total risk it can get rid of if you treat that one? So basically, the first 10% of feeders, the highest risk ones, will give you over 80% of the risk reduction of the whole lot. And this is sort of a classic 80-20 or 80-10 kind of curve. For this spatial targeting and mitigations, almost everything follows this kind of curve when you plot it out. There's a lot of variation there that gives you a lot of room to exploit the differences over space. Because in the end, we think we get 60% of the wildfire risk reduction for 2% of the cost of undergrounding. By quantifying this stuff, targeting this stuff, working as well in end-to-end from the data analysts to the legislators and getting the job done. So in conclusion, power line initiated wildfires are disproportionately dangerous. I think we kind of accept that as a fact now, even though we can't explain it. Multiple mitigations do exist. You can put stuff underground, you can put new protection on. Risk is very spatially dependent, and this actually makes targeted risk reduction an economic proposition. You can get it to pay. And government industry can and must act cooperatively and in a data-driven manner. That was the secret sauce in Victoria. That's how we actually managed to get this done, that after a Royal Commission and then the industry working together with data scientists, fire scientists, the ministries and so on, that we actually get this done. And it is a digital transformation in a couple of ways, and it's a digital transformation that really does matter. So thank you for your attention. My thanks too to all of these others who've been involved in this process that are on this slide, and I'll hand you back to Daniel.
Right, our next speaker is Dr. B. Don Russell, Distinguished Professor and Regents Professor in the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering at Texas A&M University. For over four decades, Dr. Russell has led research in real-time detection of electrical power circuit apparatus failures, downed conductors, and circuit misoperations using advanced waveform analytics. He served as the project director of the four-year Texas Powerline Caused Wildfire Mitigation Project. And Dr. Russell is a member of the National Academy of Engineering and past president of the IEEE Power and Energy Society. Dr. Russell?
Let me make sure I've got the right. It's good to be with you today. I'm the old crotchety electrical engineering guy that Simon talked about. Next year is my 50th year in this business. There is a lot to be said, and I've listened to everything since yesterday about this business of wildfires. I'm not a wildfire guy per se. I'm an electrical engineer. So I'm going to talk to you about ignition and what can be done about it. Much has been said this morning already about things you can do to harden, so forth. We're going to talk to you about some things that go a little bit beyond what you've heard so far. There's a lot of good things that I've heard since yesterday, and I made a partial list before I came here of the kinds of things that people are talking about. All the things this morning, too. Better poles, covered wires, bury it, vegetation, so forth, so forth. Even the nuclear option, which I call the cutting off the power lines in advance when you think there's something about to go wrong. The problem with that is there's something missing. And the thing that is missing is that we haven't really delved into yet in the practice in the utility industry into continuous health monitoring, electrical health monitoring of our circuits. We really haven't gotten into automated diagnostics that tell an operator what's going on with the circuit, what's broken, what's breaking as it's happening. Real time has to be real time to be effective with respect to what we've been talking about. Actionable information needs to come to the operators, and it needs to be in real time. And the solution to that that we've been developing, and the industry, power electrical engineers have been developing in the last few years, is called distribution fault anticipation. Prognostics, diagnostics, detection in advance of when the bad thing happens. And that's a key. What we normally think about an electric feeder is that it's normal and good until we know it's broken. Now, why? Because that's all we can do, right? If the lights are on and nobody's calling and our equipment's not working, and I mean not detecting any faults, life is good. Except that's not really true. We actually ran for a large number of utilities the longest running longitudinal study of power line failures that exists in the world. We have over 1,000 circuit years of monitoring, which recorded every single naturally occurring fault that occurred on over 70 feeders. Some of those circuits were monitored for 15 years straight, 24/7. Everything that happened, normal or otherwise, was recorded in high fidelity. From that database, we know that many of the things that put the lines on the ground, many of the things that caused the ignition mechanism, had long-term precursor events before the actual failure occurred. Before the wire broke, before the outage occurred, before the line was down, before that fire was burning down below, there had been precursor events. So let me give you some examples. We obviously need as early an awareness as we can of when we have a bad thing happening on our power system. When does it go unhealthy, right? So, there is a damaged power line. These are all, by the way, all these pictures I'm going to give you, nothing was staged. Everything is real from actual operating utility circuits. Be aware of that. If you look at that particular power line, you see a lot of damage. A few more hits, that's going to come down, cause a broken line. When a broken line is down, a utility guy goes out there, he finds a broken line down, he says the line's broken, he fixes it, and he writes it up. What's not known is how long it took for that line to break and what the cause was and how long that cause has been there. In this particular case, the hits that caused the broken line started in 2007, but the final event doesn't occur until 2011 or so. In that period of time, there are, as you see, those dates, those times of when we had conductor clash in that span. Utility didn't know it. Utility hadn't found it. Not their fault. Nothing they had was going to do it. Most of these faults self-heal, so it's a one-shot. They reclose. It's good. They don't even know where it occurred, et cetera, right? Except it is possible to detect the first of those faults with analytics, go to within two pole spans of where it occurred, fix it with a $20 spacer, and none of those other conductor clashes actually happen. And that's what fault anticipation is all about. Now, we can't anticipate the first one, because until there's the first one, you don't know what's going on. But as soon as you've had the first one, the idea is prevent all the rest of them. And look how long this is. This is years apart. The fire conditions on the first four might have been wet. No fire would happen. But what about the last one? Maybe that's on the dry drought condition, and that's when the fire occurs. See? All right. That clamp, a real example, eroding, is one of the causes of fires. Stuff drops out, or it erodes to the point where it drops the conductor on the ground, right? That is detectable. But no existing system used by any utility today can diagnose or identify that clamp in its earlier stages. It does not cause meters to indicate. It does not cause sustained momentaries until later in its life of deterioration. That particular clamp creates a signature that looks like that one. That is an actual signature. Okay? It's very little. There's 80 amps of load there. It only happens for a second or two. That clamp can arc for a second or two, go away, not come back for 12 hours, arc for a half a cycle to a cycle or two cycles, go away, not come back for another 3 hours, totally ignored by everything, all the meters, all the protection, all of everything. In this example right here, this is a real example from our research, where we were monitoring distribution circuit. A clamp went into an arcing condition for 21 days, okay? It went into an arc condition 2,333 times. So there were 2,333 periods of time, some of them as short as a second, when that clamp was arcing from the time that it was perfectly healthy till the time it was failing later, 21 days later. In the first 19 days there, there were absolutely no indications of anything. There were then ultimately one lights out call because one fuse blew, but they replaced the fuse, couldn't find the cause, and left. Then you have flickering lights calls for a couple of days. This is where your meters would actually give you some information, but the utility knew and they had the flickering lights call and they still couldn't find the problem. And ultimately they did have a lights out, and of course you have a lights out when the conductor breaks, but now it's of course too late to prevent the fire or the bad thing happening. So the issue here is this: what about the first 19 days when nothing is going on? There are no meters telling you anything. There's no indication on any of the utility business, all right? What about that period of time where you have a few cycles of arcing and you know that you need to do something about it if you knew about it, but that's what it looks like and it doesn't last very long? Well, the idea is this: you can use waveform analytics that will look at that waveform on a real-time basis, analyze it, and tell you that's a clamp failure. Now, it takes incredible sophisticated computer science kinds of stuff that we'll talk about in a moment, only 30 seconds, but you can do it, and that has now been shown. This is a report that we use from the equipment that we have that some of the utilities in this room are now demonstrating that shows that that clamp signature can be monitored with waveform analytics. It can be diagnosed. It can put a line on a printout, a report, a screen in the operator headquarters that says, probable failure of switcher clamp on phase B. Of course, it gives you the circuit, the substation, et cetera, et cetera. In this case, it estimated that it was 80% likelihood of clamp, 20% likelihood of switch. The reason is there's a overlap in the way waveforms look for clamps failing versus switches failing, and it's not 100% crisp. So it's a probabilistic thing. It was dropping modulating 17 kVA of the load. It happened 2,333 times in 21 days. Okay? The utility indications occurred only in the last 2 days on all the meters or anything else. And even with four truck rolls, two transformer changeouts, a fuse change out, and several other activities, the utility never found it because they didn't know it was a clamp failure. DFA devices knew it was a clamp failure. We were in a blind test where the operators didn't know what we knew. And for 19 days, we knew that it was happening before the utility knew that it was taking place. So the idea is this: that box in the middle is waveform analytics, data processing that can occur in a small box in the substation itself. You don't have to bring a bunch of raw data back to some central server in the sky. Do it in the substation with a small box that looks like a relay. It takes those waveforms on the left, the clamp one is there in the red, there's a capacitor bank failure in a can of a capacitor, there's the green one. The bottom one is a fault-induced conductor slap. It analyzes those, it says what it is, and it puts it on a report for your operator. There's a lot of stuff in it, fuzzy expert system logic, a lot of sophisticated computer science stuff. I'm a power engineering guy. I don't understand that, but I got real smart people work for me, and they do understand it. Failing substation switch is an example. This failing substation switch occurred about a month ago on one of the utilities that's demonstrating this technology. It's a rural 25 kV substation, has three circuits out of that substation. It's got hundreds of customers, not thousands, because it's a rural area, it's a co-op area. It's an incipient failure, condition that existed was found and repaired before there was any bad thing happen. No outage ever occurred. There were never a customer call. There was no indication on Stata, and there was no indication on smart meters, even after they knew the switch was arcing and they pinged the meters. DFA, this fault analytics, was able to notify the utility about the condition, okay, avoiding the outage, avoiding the catastrophic switch failure, and the substation fire. The crews went out without any real pressure, were able to fix it. There was no outage for the customers. Let's see if we can show you this. This is an iPhone capture of that arc. You see the arc at the top of the switch? Give me just a second. We'll go back. If you look at the top of the switch right in the middle, you will see it arcing. The utility said if we had not known about this, this would have likely burned the switch up, burned down part of the switch gear, and we might have lost the station entirely, and you know what that would have cost, besides being a fire ignition. If that switch was outside the substation on a location out on the line, it obviously is a fire ignition potential mechanism, right? Here's the key. Nothing the utility had, including smart meters that were pinged, showed the existence of that problem. The thing that you have to do to find that problem with that at this incipient stage, before there's an outage or a customer call, is you've got to do sophisticated waveform analytics. And this is the next step that we need to go to in the power system business, beyond all the good things that have already been talked about and been done. This is an arcing clamp, another example. This is way out on the feeder. This could be 10 miles away from the substation on one lateral, okay? Typical clamp situation, typical of all the utilities in this room. The DFA said there's an arcing clamp on this circuit, it's modulating this kind of load, et cetera. Utility launched a crew, they found this clamp burning in a national forest. This happened 3 weeks ago. If it continued to arc, it would erode that clamp, as I showed you earlier. It likely would have then dropped stuff down into the ground. We're in a fairly wet time. It probably wouldn't have caused a fire today. But if this happened in August in Texas, it probably would have started a fire. DFA was the only notice that the utility had that this was happening. There was never an outage. There's certainly no SCADA information of any kind. Nothing's operating, no protection systems, and there were never one customer call for this particular clamp outage. The visual inspection would also likely not find it. Now, this is a really important point. We've talked about needing more visual inspection, this, that, and the other. You probably won't find it. Why? It's only arcing sometimes a few seconds to 10 or 20 seconds, and then it goes away, and it may not come back for 6 hours. What's the probability you're going to be there to see it, right? Remember that 2,333 arcing conditions on the previous example, some of them were a second long to 2 or 3 seconds long, spread over 21 days. You're not going to be there to see it. And by the way, when the utility crew got there to change out all those transformers and things they thought might be bad, they were good, by the way, all good. They didn't know about the clamp. They looked at the clamp. They still couldn't see that it was the problem. So inspection's good, but diagnostics is better because you know what's going wrong with the circuit. Here's the clamp. You can look at it. You see it already up there. By the way, can you see it from where you are? Okay. That is detectable 10 miles away on a phase by analytics, not detectable by anything else, including no downstream meter indications. By the way, the wisp of smoke you saw there was not a fire. It was the lineman smoking while he's taking the picture. That's true. That's not a joke. DFA monitoring consists of what I'll show you in a minute, a DFA device looking at a circuit, one box of small electronics per circuit. You bring the stuff back, it's network-based. You can have a lineman sitting with an iPad in a truck halfway out on the feeder looking at everything that's happened on that feeder, all of the information, anytime he wants, on demand. That's the way this needs to be done. You can have an operator who's presented lines on his screen that says, you just had a X happen and it just started and this is the ones you need to go do something about. That's the kind of health assessment we've got to have on our circuits if we take the next step to where we need to be. The Texas Power Line Caused Wildfire Mitigation Project was what I led. We spent 4 years, instrumented 50 circuits with this technology and proved that you can find all of these kinds of things. Vegetation intrusion, broken insulators, charring cross arms, failed insulator arresters, arc tracking, capacitor failures, lines down on the ground, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We have a lot of history with this. We now have some of the 6 utilities that participated in this study are now rolling out this technology on their systems on a scheduled basis. 2 of the examples, vegetation fault. You see that line, that branch down on the ground, clearly an ignition mechanism. That branch had multiple flashovers detected by DFA technology for a 24-hour period. It burned the line down eventually. It was never detected by anything the utility had because all of the flashes, all of the short circuits were self-healing. They reclosed successfully. The one on the right's a vegetation fault. It had multiple flashovers over a 24-hour period. It was detected, the utility found it, they corrected it with the DFA information, and there was never an outage, there was never a bad thing took place. That's the holy grail. Get out there, find it, fix it before there's a bad thing happen. DFA technology looks like a conventional relay that you'd place in a substation. The Texas project, in the late 90s, Texas started doing wildfire risk assessment. By 2012, they had a very sophisticated computer-based risk assessment program. This right here doesn't project very well. Well, yours is better than mine. The red areas to the half of the state to the left, that's where fires occur. That's where our big fires occur. It rains in the right third of the state. That's where the green is. That's where the pine forests are. It doesn't rain. It rains a lot, not a lot of fires. The risk is right there in the middle. If you mine in on it, that's what it looks like. You mine in on it again, that's the capital, Austin. Many of the big fires in Texas over the last few years, that's where they've been, in that red area. If you look at the red area there, right above that, that's the worst part. On that day, that was the worst place we would look for a fire. It actually was the place we had a big fire, predicted 2 days earlier. But here's the key. If we superimpose the electric circuits on that area, and we tie what was talked about yesterday, which is the risk assessment that you're doing, San Diego Gas and Electric talked about great work on where is the red areas of our geography that where we're going to have a real problem. Overlay the electric circuits on it, and then the next step, the one that is so far missing, is there's a fault. How do you want to know when to turn that line off? I'll tell you why. If waveform analytics says you just had an arcing clamp start to arc, or you just had a conductor clash that self-healed, or you just have an X, Y, or Z happening, that gives you a reason to take that circuit off if the winds are 70 miles an hour and the area is red. So the analytics gives you the real-time information to make the decision to turn the circuit off. But before that, it may have already days later, 2 weeks later, or in the case of the conductor clash example I gave you, 4 years earlier told you, go fix this, and then you don't have to worry about it on the red flag day. And that's what this is all about. You can't detect everything, but waveform analytics in fault anticipation will reduce the risk, enabling utilities to find and fix many of the hazards, including switches like that one arcing I showed you, clamps, no, there are untold numbers of examples of this. Vegetation at the top, that's an experiment in my laboratory. The brush on the ground and lines down on the ground that start fire, which is also at our lab. Bottom line, everything that I have heard in the last 2 days is a great thing to try to do. Okay, the modeling, everything. The next thing is, you've done a lot of things to improve S&C and Teleruptor's great technology. Sean Esty and I are good friends, vacationed last year in Patagonia together. He's got a wonderful program there. But there's another layer, and we are now capable with analytics to add a layer on top of all those great things I've heard, which says, tell us the instant a bad thing starts to fail on this circuit. And when you can, which is a lot of the time, tell us what it is. And that's what this is all about. Thank you very much.
All right, at this time we're going to take a short break to allow the different tracks to break out. So again, if you're staying for breakout track session 3, that'll be located here. And our breakout session 4 will actually be located in the Redwood Room. So out these doors and to the left. Thank you. Thank you. And for those of you who are joining us here in track three, we'll be starting shortly. So now be a great time to grab some coffee and grab a seat. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're getting started to begin our breakout track three, turning data into information. Best practices in data gathering and analytics for utilities. So if you please take your seats, we'll get our next round of lightning presentation started. I'm going to ask our next two lightning presenters to move to the stage. We have Tony Palazzi, Regional Service Line Manager of Power Americas, Fugro, coming from Australia, presenting on geo-intelligence and asset integrity. And we also have Andrew Mills, President of Ericsson's Commercial Group, giving a lightning presentation talk on the future of aerial resources.
Good morning. How are you doing? Okay, my name is Tony Palazzi. I'm with Fugro. I run the power business for the Americas. I'd like to thank everybody for participating. This has been pretty interesting. Last day or so has been interesting to listen to some of the other folks talk, and hopefully you're getting something out of this. So what I'm going to talk about today is going to be really about, this thing works here. It's not progressing. Yep. There we go. Well, as we know, we've heard a lot about how the world is changing and all the different aspects that are causing issues, not only for the environment, the public, but also for utilities. And these are being caused by a lot of different things, climate change being one, regulations, different compliance. And what those things revolve around is really how a utility, in this particular case, is going to address some of those things and how they're going to deal with some of these events and issues, not only today, but going forward. So what utilities are really looking for, are looking at, is to really solve some big problems. There's fires, there's storms, there's disasters of all different types, shapes, and colors. Again, regulations, different compliance issues they have to deal with, public scrutiny, all different types of things. So how are they going to deal with these big problems, and what are they going to do in order to continue with their mission with reliability and safety and ensuring that things are going to be there, you know, not only today, but beyond. So really what they need in most cases is solutions that are proven, that are reliable, that are sustainable and defensible. And these are really important, I think, and I think most of you would agree that that's kind of some of the solutions they're trying to look for to solve some of these big problems. One aspect of this is really around, I'm going to talk about it's kind of a little bit of a story, but it's solutions that have been around for a while. One of the solutions that we have is called Roams. It's a SaaS platform, if you will, that was designed, and I'll talk about the history of it in a minute, but really to help utilities operate better, be more reliable, be more safe, reduce cost. The platform is a SaaS platform. It utilizes different types of remote sensing technologies, along with data analytics, data processing, computer data processing, in order for the utility to not only find out where all their stuff is, but actually do some predictive analysis against that and generate what we call a 4D visual world of their network, their whole environment. And being proven in the sense that it's been around for quite some time, 10 years, it's been deployed in many different parts of the globe, as well as here in the United States. So the history of this, I think the gentleman that was from Australia, I don't have an Australian accent, unfortunately, otherwise I'd probably get a little more attention. But I work with a lot of Aussies, since this is where it was visually designed and developed, by utility for utility. So the brief history around this is Ergon Energy generated or helped build this product as they split out a different group called Roams right after the big Black Sunday that was mentioned not too long ago. In the last talk. So it was designed so they wouldn't have to endure some of those same problems. But what they found out originally was after that, as a result of that, is they didn't know where all their assets were. They didn't know how many assets they had. They didn't know what the condition of those assets were in relationship to the condition, but also to its surroundings. So they embarked on this journey, if you will, in order to create something that wouldn't happen again. And this is really the 4D visual asset management
and turn that into more of a digital utility, not only from the aspect of gathering the right type of information through remote sensing technologies, in this particular case, LIDAR and imagery, but also other data that they could add to it, but doing it in a way that was on scale. You saw the size of the areas that they're dealing with are really about the size of about a third of the eastern seaboard that's currently being covered, as well as other places around the globe. But it had to be that scale, it had to be accurate, it had to be complete, and it had to be defensible. So they embarked on this effort to create this. So really, they collected the data, they turned that data into information, they processed it appropriately, and they deployed it across their enterprise through a visual tool, as well as some analytics on the back end. But what's going to do is to go through this process. I'll try to take you through this a little bit. It's really the first thing they do is what we do is we take the utilities network, we fly the area, we take their network, we ingest it in the system, and basically match it to reality. In most cases of all the implementations we've done globally, the average is that most of the utilities are off by at least 20 to 30% of the amount of assets that they think they have. And that's in the plus. And in most cases, where they think their assets are, they're off, and typically for poles, if you will, in this particular example, are on average off by 250 feet. So right then and there, you can kind of get an idea that if they send somebody out there, they're going to spend some time looking for it, or they may not find it at all because they may not even know where it is. Asset match basically takes where the LIDAR is to a high level of accuracy, and it basically corrects the network where it should be in reality. Next thing they do after that is really to reduce the risk is to come up with clearance. So as this information is extracted out of the LIDAR, you get every pole, every wire, every conductor, and everything else. And then from that, you get a high-resolution elevation model. So you can be able to turn all the lines, all the poles, and everything in relation to the ground and to the top of pole. In addition to that, you can do vegetation management, which is one aspect of this, where you can actually, when you extract all that information, you extract all the poles, all the wires, all the vegetation, all the structures, so everything, roads, the whole nine yards. So you get a whole complete picture of your network in relation to all of its environment in X, Y, and Z. And from there, you can actually do asset condition on top of those assets. In this particular case, it's poles. On the top of the poles, what's on the poles, what the condition of them are, and append that to the actual structure that you have that's accurate in the system. So most of these, in this particular example, these inspections are being done in the office, the information is being collected out in the field, and then on a real-time basis, it's being processed and appended to that pole or that asset, and the inspectors are actually doing the inspection in the office in real time. Part of this was also for the groups we're working with, for in this particular case, either it's Essential or Ergon. They used it for disaster management. In this particular case, it was for Cyclone Debbie. So they were able, not because they knew where all their assets were, they knew where their conditions were, they knew where they were in relation to everything else around them. They can actually do some predictive analysis based on the weather, based on the storm, based on all the other information they were getting, where that could actually impact their network and their assets, and basically deploy things appropriately from a preemptive aspect as well as a post. In this particular case, they had everything up in record time. You can also do tree species identification. This is real important when you're looking for dead trees, the health of trees, for example. What other trees are impeding upon the right-of-way? I think it was mentioned earlier from Florida Power and Light, and most of their problems come from trees that are outside the right-of-way. So now that you have an aspect of the information that you collect when you collect your service territory, you're able to tell where those other potential trees and the potential dangers could be to your assets. And with that, you get all this wonderful information from the data that you can actually start doing predictive analysis. And this particular example here on the bottom right is really the utilities taking that and looking at where they need to do their next vegetation cycle. And they're planning it out not only next year, 3 years, 5 years, 10 years. It's based on their budget, but also based on they can determine at this point, after having this information, that information being processed, they can determine the volumetrics of each one of these areas that's impeding upon the line where the vegetation is encroaching. So then from that, they can determine where they need to set their priorities based on their business roles. That's just one example of some predictive analytics. So next, I'm going to give you this video right here. I'll just let this go real quick.
Australia's largest electricity network, so large it can be seen from space. Spanning 737,000 square kilometres of regional and rural New South Wales, Essential Energy's 200,000 kilometre network is complex. It's typically long and radial in nature, with the longest lines extending over 1,000 kilometres. To enhance its understanding and management of network risk, Essential Energy has been using ROAM's technology to build a three-dimensional virtual world representation of the network. ROAMS does this by using LiDAR technology and ultra-high resolution imagery. Aircraft mounted with sensors are used to efficiently capture the position of every asset to millimeter accuracy, every pole, every crossarm, every conductor and insulator, including the surrounding corridor, so that the complete operating environment for every part of the network can be used for works delivery and asset management. Objects are created that represent the network components, along with surrounding natural and man-made features. The ROAMS virtual world creates a platform which can attach images taken from anywhere on the network to provide a record of asset condition. The image resolution and algorithms applied means a consistent process is applied whether there are no defects identified or where rectification is required. By creating objects that represent the physical characteristics of real-life network components, scenario analysis is carried out using client-provided business rules. For example, the forecast growth of individual trees and the clearance of the network to ground can be assessed for each and every asset. This means that risk can be assessed and visualized across the whole network. By providing the full context of the surrounding environment, ROAMS assists network businesses apply a more sophisticated risk assessment approach. Network defects that would have been treated the same can now be assessed using environmental risk factors made available. For example, features such as land use, trafficable roads, bushfire risk, and accessible sites can be considered in defect prioritization. Laborious span-by-span analysis is automated to make work more efficient. While the problems are not new, Essential Energy's use of ROAMS is harnessing a new and emerging technology solution that provides transparency of its network health. The information builds a powerful bottom-up investment justification for all stakeholders, including field staff, asset managers, boards and regulators. So it is now possible to assess network risk at a higher granularity in a single keystroke, making ROAMS technology truly transformational. What does this mean for Essential Energy? Better risk management, informed decision-making based on accurate network data, and better use of available resources.
So it's kind of a encapsulation of, kind of, at least from Essential's perspective, what they got out of it. And what they did, again, is at the end of the day, is they went through a digital transformation, and you've heard that term many times, and that's what they did. And most of our customers are taking this same journey, realizing a lot of different types of benefits, not only from increased reliability, safety is obviously one of those two of their main objectives, reduce the overall risk. They're saving some tremendous amount of money in deploying this type of technology, but also delivering it at scale, you know, doing large areas from, you know, huge networks, if you will. So really what we do at the end of the day is we basically what we have kind of coined is create a single version of truth for the whole entire enterprise. So I hope that was helpful. Is there questions? Otherwise, thank you very much. I appreciate it.
There you go. You're up, bud.
That works?
I think so.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. I'm Andy Mills. I'm the president of Ericsson Air Crane. And we're coming to you with a little bit of a different perspective than a number of the other speakers here in that we are first and foremost aviation operators, although we are involved in airborne technology as well. And I'm just going to give you a very quick and broad overview of using some of the aerial resources at our disposal these days and what we think will happen in the near future for managing both risk and active suppression. If the slide changes, that is. There we go. So we are the builder and the operator of the S-64 air crane heavy helitanker firefighting helicopter. I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about that. I'll just tell you that we are the largest commercial heavy lift firefighting operator in the world. We have more of these aircraft than anyone. We fight fire all over the world. We have operations in Canada, Greece, Australia, Chile, Italy, Turkey, France. The gentleman we're up here talking about, Australia, we have four aircraft in Victoria, Australia, fighting fire today. And we have two in Chile today fighting fire in the southern hemisphere. And if you saw the fires in Athens last summer, the terrible fires that killed a number of people there, we had five of our aircraft flying continuously on those fires. In addition to that, here in California, we operate for CAL FIRE, Los Angeles County, Los Angeles City, San Diego County, the U.S. Forest Service, and a partnership with SDG&E Utility. So this is a landscape we're intimately familiar with. We've been doing this for 40 years. And what I want to share with you today is some of the airborne resources that are being utilized that make our jobs a little easier. The aircraft you see on the bottom of the slide here is just to show you that we do more than firefighting. Obviously, the principal reason we're all here today is for fire. But we also fly light and medium helicopters and fixed wing, and we do surveillance and we do aerial mapping. So that leads us into what we're here to talk about today, which is technology. Aerial resources that are being used today and into the future, I think. Obviously, satellites are in a different category. And we have subject matter experts that are going to speak to you here very shortly that know far more than I do about the data itself and the usefulness of that data. But roughly speaking, when it comes to airborne platforms, we really have three available to us today. They boil down to helicopters, fixed wing, and unmanned aerial vehicles, drones. And the interesting chronology here is that for years and years and years, what little data we could get both pre-fire and during fires came from fixed wings. And a lot of it still does come from fixed wings, as you'll see in a minute. That was the primary resource. With the advent of LIDAR and IR cameras that were much, much more detailed, started having more and more of those mounted on helicopter platforms. And the utilities, especially several of the ones that are in this room today, were real leaders in that regard. And now, of course, we have drone technology, and the drones are assuming a bigger and bigger role all the time. And going forward, I think that they will become an even bigger part of the fire landscape in terms of providing data to us that's useful. The problem right now, of course, is a lot of the drones are very limited in how long they can stay aloft and how far they can fly, things like that. And the FAA is still in the middle of figuring out how they're going to regulate drones, both in and out of temporary flight-restricted areas like big fires. So quickly, there's a decision path here where, first of all, decision makers decide what kind of data they want, and then they tell us, hey, this is what we need, how can you do it? And we provide the aerial platform to them, either helicopters or fixed wing, in our case, drone manufacturers and operators and others. We collect the data, and then there's execution. And it's important to know that the timeline really boils down into two things. There's long scope timeline where you're engaged in mitigation and trying to understand how to prevent fires. And there's short term execution. Fires are starting, they've already started, you need to map them in real time. Those are two really different things, but some of the same tools are used for both. So I don't really need to go over this. This is sort of the same thing as I was just mentioning. But the decision path boils down into the longer term mitigation, which is vegetation growth, soil drought index, overgrowth, power line encroachment. You've already heard quite a bit about that from other folks here. Structure threat mapping. And what I mean by that is out in the WUI, the wildland urban interface, mapping homes, either through aerial photography or satellite imagery, that are in areas that are prone to wildfire, and knowing in advance where those structures are and what you're going to protect and what you're not. And power line sag and high heat events. They use LIDAR for this mostly, and primarily helicopter mounted at this point. There's some incredible LIDAR data that comes from satellites as well, but most of the utilities use helicopters for power line sag measurements because it measures down to the millimeter. And then the second category I would say is threat identification and accurate initial attack. Fires break out, are you able to triangulate and come up with accurate positioning on that so that you direct ground and air resources to it accurately, and real-time fire mapping. These are the different types of things that you typically see mounted on aerial platforms today, both drones and helicopters and fixed wing. Infrared camera, thermal imaging, corona cameras, high-resolution photo, and good old human spotters, which are still an integral part of the whole process. And all of these things have to be used together. You don't use one over another. Corona camera, you just saw some interesting things from some of our compatriots here. I won't go into great detail on that, but this is a typical light helicopter. That is a corona camera along with a FLIR and IR unit mounted right on the nose. That's what it looks like. And they're typically used to identify, at source insulators and power lines that are malfunctioning so they can be fixed before they break down and start a fire. LIDAR, many of the people in this room are far more expert on LIDAR than I am. But light detection and ranging has assumed such an incredible role. These two slides, the one on the left is terrain mapping, and the one on the right is where it's been overlaid with vegetation. And this was done by a BC Hydro, a company that we work with up in Canada. And they fly their power lines with helicopters mounted with LIDAR many times a year just so they can map the changes in vegetation. And a big chunk of that is now strictly for firefighting reasons. This is a LIDAR image from satellite imagery, and you can sort of see the difference. Also fantastic data, but used for slightly different things. Infrared camera, the U.S. government and the Forest Service are big users of this. Both of the aircraft pictured here, that Citation II jet and the King Air 200, the Forest Service has a whole fleet of these and the Department of the Interior, and they use them primarily for fire mapping. So when big forest fires break out, or even relatively small ones, they will dispatch these aircraft. They might do multiple fires a day. And so what starts to happen is we get fire pictures every single day. And the reason that's important is a lot of times when you're out on a fire, it might be have remote areas, it might be up in the Sierras in California or other places, you may or may not be able to tell the extent. Incident commander on the ground has to assign resources, and without an accurate fire map, he can't do it. And it wasn't that long ago when somebody would just get in a spotter plane and fly around and hand sketch a boundary and land and go, this is what I think's happening. Those days are gone, and as we go into the future, more and more you're going to see drones being used to do this. They're doing it now. Department of Interior has over 50 drones in their program, and they've used several of those for mapping. I was on a fire last year in the Northwest where we had the fixed wing fly over once a day and map the fire, but then they brought a drone in, and the drone was flying twice a day and augmenting the data that we had, and you're able to build what you're looking at there is a fire progression map. It shows the fire as it's growing twice a day. And the example that is useful for this is in Southern Oregon last year. Obviously, California had a terrible fire season last year. What a lot of people don't realize is Oregon also had a terrible fire season, over 500,000 acres burned. And in Southern Oregon, we had a lightning event come through. It lasted less than 8 hours. It started 212 fires in 8 hours. And a lot of those fires started to quickly burn together, and smoke encapsulated the region. So incident commanders are on the ground. They know they have fires all over the place. They have heavy smoke. They can't even see it. And in most of those places, they could not get ground crews in, rugged area. So between drones and fixed wing, they were able to fly and produce extremely accurate maps of not only where the fires were and where they were spreading, but where the real hotspots were. Then they dispatched people like us with our heavy heli tankers to go out and to use the technical term, pound the crap out of it. High-resolution photo, also still used to a great extent, also for power line monitoring. In this example, power line corridors, you can see on the left, that corridor is heavily overgrown, and on the right, that's an example of a well-cleared power line. But they also still use it for not only fire mitigation, but active fire mapping in conjunction with the IR cameras. And of course, human spotters. Technology is a fantastic thing, but there comes a point where you've still got to have eyes in the sky. That on the right there, that's a Cal Fire OV-10 Bronco fixed wing spotter and air attack aircraft. And on the left, that's a helicopter doing visual spotting on a pipeline job. But the key here is you have to use all of these tools in conjunction with the human interface. So you get post-collection analysis performed. The data is put together for mitigation. Plans are put in place to cut vegetation back. All of those good things happen. And then what happens when you have an actual event is all of this data that's been collected on these airborne platforms becomes extremely useful. Because option number two is what you do with this data when you have an initial attack response. And in the old days, what would happen is a fire would break out, and I can tell you from the aviation world, and what would happen is first they would send some small light helicopters, and then they would send some medium helicopters, and then they'd say, wow, this fire is getting big. And then they'd dispatch big aircraft like ours and fixed-wing air tankers. And now what happens is we've already mapped all the water sources in the area. We've already mapped all the structures in the area. We already have accurate fire locations, both because of airborne technology, but also ground-based technology and the cameras that they were talking about yesterday. You can triangulate things right away. So instead of one of our pilots being handed a slip of paper that says, fly out to Gooseneck Mountain and see if you can find that fire, they get a lat and a long and they fly directly to the fire. And the end result of that is they're much more, not only much more effective, but you can also decide what assets to put on the fire. I think you've heard the last 2 days people making mentions of Type 1 and Type 2 and Type 3 helicopters. What that really is a Type 1 is a very large heavy helitanker like ours. It's typically 700 gallons or more. Ours hold 2,600 gallons at max capacity. And a Type 2 is sort of a medium-sized helicopter like the SDG&E helicopter in this picture. And a Type 3 is a very light aircraft, just for your own edification. And this is where the proverbial rotor hits the air. When you get all of that information, then you have an integrated response with air and ground assets. Yesterday, I heard Chief Meacham mention from San Diego, he mentioned the Alpine fire where they had a fire break out after they were already fighting another fire, and it was near a trailer park. There were a lot of elderly citizens living there. They were scared to death they were going to have fatalities, and they dispatched a number of ground units, and he said the very first asset on the scene was our Type 1 helitanker, which is this aircraft right here. And that never would have happened in the old days because we probably wouldn't have even gotten on that fire that quickly, and we probably wouldn't have had an accurate location. But all of that has changed and is going to continue to change as we go forward. And the one thing I have to stress, I heard it yesterday, but I'm in total agreement with this, is that the end result of all of this, of everybody in this room and all the technology we apply, along with prevention, of course, is the tools that enable the ground firefighters to stop this fire and put it out. How do you best support the ground firefighter? That's our job too in aviation. We support the ground firefighters as best we can. So when the time comes, when those firefighters and people that I work with put their lives between citizens and the fire, let's make sure they've got the best possible tools. Airborne assets these days have come a long way. You're going to hear more about that from some folks who are subject matter experts. I just wanted to give you a general introduction and realize that all of this ties back into how effective can you be in firefighting when things do go south on you. And that's the goal of everyone in this room, I think. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Tony and Andrew. So our next panel is focusing on aerial patrols, best practices in data gathering, and analysis for utility vegetation management and asset integrity. So I'll welcome to the stage our moderator, Matt Rommel with Deloitte's US Drone Service, and our panelist, Chuck Anderson with ECI, Jeff Philippe with Intel Fuse from Australia, Kerry Fleming from the Federal Aviation Administration, and Tom Fries with San Diego Gas and Electric.
All right, thanks to Dan. I also want to thank Lisa from CPUC as well for coordinating this. So good morning, everyone. As Dan introduced, we're going to be talking about aerial collected data and how to use that data to create impact for asset management, specifically going to pay a little credence to vegetation management utilities. So just to start off a little bit, I think you guys have been hearing quite a lot about how this industry is maturing, getting to a point where there's actually practical impact coming from this technology, which is why I was so excited when I got offered the chance to be here today to moderate this panel, because we're seeing this in the industry today. This technology, drones, the corresponding analysis is actually creating impact for our clients, our panelists. They've told me they've been seeing the same. It's not quite the pie in the sky that it was a few years ago, which is pretty exciting stuff. So today, we want that to be the theme of our talk. Our talk today is going to be about practical impact. We want you guys to walk away understanding things that you guys can employ if you're an end user, if you're a utility sitting out there, if you're a service provider, understanding some best practices, et cetera. So those are basically the goals of what we want to do. The structure of how we're going to get there, we're going to leverage the expertise of the gentleman on my left, and we're going to go through, allow them to make some opening statements, give their point of view on the industry themselves. And then after that, we're going to talk a couple of practical impact stories. We're going to touch on two things within that segment of the conversation. Number one, we're going to talk about routine operations. How can you leverage drones, helicopters, the corresponding sensor technology, and then analyze that data to lower your risk, increase your operational efficiency in your portfolio? Number two, what happens after routine operations when there is an event? Unfortunately, that does happen. How do we respond to those? We'll wrap everything up, give these guys a chance to make a closing statement. Then we'll save some time for Q&A with you guys as well. So I am going to cheat and use my notes just to make sure I don't disrespect any of the gentlemen on my left and get their titles correct. And I'll introduce myself first. So I'm Matt Rommel again. I'm the commercial market leader for our U.S. drone services team. And I get to do exciting things like this, which is great. So on my left, we'll go in order from left to right. So first, we've got Tom Fries immediately to my left, the aviation services manager from San Diego Gas and Electric. Next up, we've got Kerry Fleming, who is the air traffic security from the Federal Aviation Administration. So we've got an FAA guy up here for you guys. And then next up, we've got Chuck Anderson, who's the EVP and Chief Strategy Officer from ECI Consulting. And then lastly down, we've got Jeff Phillip, General Manager and Co-Founder, Intel Fuse from Australia. Jeff clearly is going to have the best voice up here. He's got an awesome Australian accent. So he's going to, you know, give us some patience with the rest of our non-cool accents up here. So, without further ado, I'm going to kick it to these guys and allow them to give their opening statement, point of view on where they see the industry. And I think we've got a really unique collection of individuals up here. We put a lot of thought into how we're going to comprise this panel. So, if you're thinking in your head, Tom, we've got an end user sitting right next to me. He knows what's working in the industry. Kerry gets to look at everybody and say, you know, whether or not that's allowed. He's our, you know, kind of regulatory backstop up here. Chuck and Jeff are the ones out there actually implementing these items. So it's going to be a nice back and forth ping-ponging between, hey, we feel this is viable. Well, Tom's going to be able to fact check that and say, yeah, but the ROI isn't there. Kerry's going to be able to say, yeah, that's actually not, you know, allowed, but here's how the FAA is looking at that. So I'm really excited to just to be up here and enable that back and forth. So again, sit back. We'll talk to you guys for a while. We don't have any slides. We're just going to do a little bit of a TED Talk up here and speak to you guys. And at the end, we'll save some time for questions and answers. So we'll do opening statements now on how they're viewing the industry. So we can go right in order. Tom?
Thank you. So good morning, everybody. I'm Tom Fries again from San Diego Gas and Electric with the aviation services manager out there. We have we like to consider our UAS program as, you know, still rather new. We've really been operating since about 2013. What we started with was a very strong foundation, which has really helped us a lot. We put a lot of policies, procedures in place. We worked with the FAA. We built those relationships. And we're working with about 15 Part 107 operators. We have 20 to 25 really off-the-shelf UAS drones, if you will, that we use. And as you can imagine, from 2013 to today, what we used to have at probably about a $30,000 cost has really morphed down to a $1,000 drone and has even better capability, be it pictures or whatever it might be. So we've really grown in that respect from the technology perspective. We're always maintaining that, trying to stay ahead of that wave, making sure that probably every about 2 years that we're moving off something that, hey, that's too big, that's too old, it's too cumbersome. There's obviously a lot of software out there that we're using to make sure that where we're flying is in the proper areas, the coordination, ensuring that we're doing everything right. So that's really the foundation of our program at SDG&E. It has become another tool in the toolbox. And we have supervisors out there who say, okay, we need to fly this. We're going to go out and fly this drone. What's relatively new to us is we've actually started using our fire coordinators to fly these also. So most of them being former firemen, at least the two pilots we have right now, both former firemen, they have the relationship, they can coordinate with the incident commander and where they need to fly, where they can fly, or when they can and cannot fly. As you've probably heard a lot of the stories that are out there, once the drones fly, the helicopters will go away. It's a true coordination piece that we're starting to take a look at and see how effective we can do that should there be an incident. Again, we're really trying to build a program, always maintaining that solid foundation. We obviously fly helicopters. We do a lot of aerial work, pole sets, et cetera. It's about 3,000 to 4,000 hours per year of helicopter work that we're also monitoring through our aviation services division. But again, we're always trying to mature, looking for what technology is out there, how we can use that technology, will it integrate into our system, do we need to upgrade our systems? So it's less about the actual drone itself, it's more about what's next, what can we do with the data we're collecting. I'm sure you've heard a lot about data. I know there's another panel on the data itself, but how do we use that data to make something useful so somebody can make a decision. So really always looking at that sort of vision of that full autonomous system going out there, taking a look at something, giving us enough information to make decisions remotely, really is sort of our vision for our UAS program. But again, going back to that basic foundation is really what we're always trying to make sure we're achieving with our UAS system.
Yeah, thanks, Tom. And being pretty familiar with what they're doing down there at SDG&E, I can say that they've been very innovative and they are taking those steps. And the one thing that resonated with me from what you said is that if you just go and collect a bunch of data with your drones are better access, right? Flying selfie stick or helicopters, et cetera, then you just wind up with a data problem, right? So you've got to have a good strategy behind that so you can actually create impact out of it. Kerry?
Hi, my name's Kerry Fleming. In airspace security, I work for the government, and I actually am here to help. You don't hear that a lot from government employees, especially in the regulatory section of the government. A previous speaker had talked about UAS's, drones, and TFRs and getting access to that airspace. And that actually was why my group was initially brought in, was drones and UASs are now taking over a lot of the former operations that helicopters and planes would have in surveying the landscape, going up when there's emergencies and disasters. And when drones started becoming more of a factor, there really wasn't a whole lot of yes going on from the government. A lot of it was being stuck in flight standards and a UAS office that their instinct was no, because they didn't understand how the technology was changing rapidly and how to help integrate what you needed and what the community needed. And there's sometimes a disconnect. So I was fortunate enough to work in a group where my boss, former military, who said, it's not a matter of yes or no, it's how to get to yes, how to make it work. And we started working with all the first responders, law enforcement. Whenever there's a disaster, whenever there's an event, we're the ones that get called and we're the ones who give authorization. We will either tell you yes or we will tell you how to get to yes. It's not always that easy. And we understand that everything is changing. And this is an important part of the FAA going forward. And sometimes you have to step on toes to get there. And sometimes you need people who don't want to tell people no. They want to tell them yes. And we've stepped on a lot of toes already. We're not highly thought of in other parts of the FAA. You know, those people who tell you no, they have a hard problem and a hard time with my group. Drones and UAS are here. You have to use it. It's a great tool to use. Where my group comes in is mainly when there's a disaster, when there's an event. We work with groups that are working with Cal Fire. We work with the Forest Service, DOI, and all your law enforcement on the West Coast. You have different groups that go up. And when there's TFRs in place that the Forest Service has to have to protect the area around a fire so that the first responders and the fire units can get in there and get it out as quickly as possible, we're the group that gives the authorization into the TFRs. We work 24/7, and we have the most highly experienced people in my group with me. We know the airspace, we know what your needs are, and case in point, last year with the hurricanes, we processed probably 300 authorizations to get into all those different hurricanes, and that's really where we started coming into our own with being integrated into this process. And this year already, we're over 200, and that's just drone use on an emergency basis. So when you have a fire and you have drones that need to get up and assist, we're the group that is giving them that access, working with the local authorities to make sure that this is seamless, that everybody is coordinated with, and that there are no problems on the communication front. That's key to all of this, working with Cal Fire and everybody else. You can't have any mistakes. And 30 years in the government, 20 years in air traffic, I'm not a big fan of mistakes. It doesn't work well for our industry. And I'll give it back to Matt right now.
Yeah, so it's got to be clear to you guys now that Kerry is very progressive. There's a reason why we wanted him to be here today. And from knowing him for a while and firsthand, I can confirm that multiple times, specifically with wildfire efforts, et cetera, this is the guy who picks up the phone and grants those beyond visual line of sight waivers so that way action can be taken to save lives, public safety, et cetera. So really glad he was able to make it out here with us today. And at Deloitte, we have a thing where we take our business chemistry tests, and if you're very innovative or progressive, you're called a pioneer. So I always think of Kerry as like the ultimate FAA pioneer who's ready to, you know, reset the boundaries. And if you've got a chance to pull him aside after we get off stage up here, ask him about how it was coordinating the air traffic for the Super Bowl this year. It's a very good story, and it's pretty funny. Chuck, over to you.
Good morning. Thank you for the opportunity to be here today. Yesterday and this morning, just an amazing step forward in the level of technology that's available. And I think one of the things I would hope that comes out of today's conversation is really about, I think the discussion starts shifting to, it's no longer more about technology, and it's more about how do we effectively deploy that technology in a real and meaningful way to the utility industry, and specifically in this case, for the protection of wildfire, prevention and protection of wildfires. One of the common themes yesterday was the need for better data. Better data is a constant theme We're going to walk through an example of maybe how we would approach that in a few minutes. But one of the things that I really got excited about was the discussion about the demonstration of the Wildfire platform and the ability to bring that data in from multiple sources and 2D and three-dimensional data into a platform that can be accessible by a broad community of users and stakeholders. One of the biggest, I think if I look back on my career, I used to manage one of the larger data remote sensing firms for the utility industry, and we would capture thousands and thousands of miles of really rich LiDAR data. You saw earlier the presentation from Rome's where they were showing the data collection and all the potential that can be derived out of that data. But what my experience was much different than that. We were collecting that data, and we knew, the vendors all knew, the whole vendor community knew that the data is incredibly rich, could be used for so many other purposes. And when you'd go back to but our deliverables were a two-dimensional PDF deliverable of a plan and profile map at the end of a multi-million dollar exercise for utility, and we would drop off hard drives of massive amounts of data, and they didn't have the infrastructure to handle it. And so you'd go back in 2 or 3 years and, you know, ask if they've ever used that data for any other purpose, and the answer was nine times out of 10 or even more, no. It's still sitting in my closet collecting dust. And it was really unfortunate to have this data set, and I think we need to really figure out how to change that. And one of the reasons I really got excited about the Wildfire application is that's maybe one of the ways that you could change the start changing that and not only using it for the specific use case of vegetation management or engineering design, but thinking about that same data set being used for other use cases. And that's really what we want to talk about today. And one of the other common themes is the cost of information, the cost of that data. When you start talking to utilities about, you know, that information, their common, you know, answer is, well, it's too expensive. I can't afford that. And I think we can change that. We can talk about how to get cross-functional use cases rather than one specific use case. The last point I'll make is outside of the utility industry, but I think relevant to this discussion, is other forms of data that are out there that are being collected from many different sources. I had a specific example where Sonoma County, I worked with NASA on a carbon monitoring program to map the entire county of Sonoma with 8 points per square meter LiDAR data and high resolution imagery. And what I don't know, I'm not connected with the fire community here, I'm sure that data would be enormously helpful for use in wildfire modeling. And whether that data was known in advance that it was available or not is a question. And I think we need to be able to address that as a community. Where is all this data? It's somewhere out there, and there's these massive, rich data sets that could be used for many purposes. So hopefully that'll be part of the discussion as we go forward and leave this conference, is how do we take advantage of this incredibly rich data set that's being collected as we speak, thousands of miles being driven autonomously. The data mapping that was done in advance for that also has potential benefits to be useful in solving some of our big problems. So with that, I'll turn it over to Jeff.
Yeah, thanks, Chuck, and it's a perfect transition into Jeff. From getting to know Chuck and Jeff well through this process, their companies are doing some pretty amazing things with that data and creating end user impact, and we'll hear a little bit more about that from Jeff, and be prepared. Now it's time to get his awesome Australian accent going up here. So, Jeff, over to you.
Yeah, thanks, Matt. I hope nobody's disappointed, but interestingly enough, I was saying to these guys this morning, for some crazy reason, Americans still like to hear Australian accents. Now, I just cannot work it out. As I look around the room, I think what's very, very obvious to me, it's the same audience here as it is in Australia. Everybody's been around. You've been in the industry for a long time. And I think the thing that I notice in being involved in the industry is we're seeing cycles of things evolve. And one of the interesting things when I was watching Simon's presentation this morning about some of the impacts in Australia from we call them bushfires. So we made changes, we implemented things from fires that happened in the 1980s. And the changes that we made, and I'll give you one example, we got rid of wooden cross arms, went away from wooden poles to try and move to steel cross arms. And we found that this created a problem with concrete poles and steel reinforcement of flashovers of birds. So how we tried to solve that was put bird covers on there. And that created the next problem. So that's what we were seeing in the industry, is we were trying to fix things, but they were creating the next problem. And that's what we're seeing with evolution of technology. And we talked today about LiDAR, and it sounds like this great solution. And we've been using LiDAR for 10 years. In Australia, LiDAR is used across not only the transmission networks, but the distribution networks. But we're seeing this wave of issue, just like Chuck said. We've got all this data and people aren't using it. So it's like a continuum from you've got data, you turn that into information, you draw knowledge from it, and from that knowledge you draw wisdom. So unfortunately, we're not moving down that continuum as quick as we should be. We're not drawing knowledge and wisdom from that data, and we're not using it the way we should. And I guess at the end of the day, when we look at some of the great things that are happening across all of these areas, some are very strategic. Some of the things that we're speaking, that we're talking about in Australia, the changes that we've made are from the major fire, the Black Saturday fire we had in 2009. Now that was 10 years ago. So we don't have time as an audience to wait 10 years for all of the things that we're talking about to unfold. There will be some strategic things that will take that long, but we need to come up with solutions and walk out of this room with knowing what are the things that we can do today. So hopefully, as you listen to some of the things that we talk about as a panel, some of those things will become more apparent to you. And we learn from the past, and we learn from those cycles that we don't just implement technology for technology's sake, that we don't we don't get all this data and not know how to use it. So that's my hope out of these couple of days, that we learn some of those things.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks, Jeff. And that's a perfect segue into the meat of our presentation. So we're going to take about the next 20, 25 minutes, which I've referred to these guys as about like ping pong. It's going to kind of fade into the back here, set up a little bit of structure, and allow them to just play off of one another. So we're going to talk about two things. One is routine operations and how we can use these technologies and the corresponding data to increase operational efficiency, manage the asset portfolio, and then lower that risk portfolio as well. So routine operation, asset management, specifically touching on some of the vegetation management stuff. Then we'll get into a session two, as long as I can wrangle these guys back in, and talk about what it's like to use the technologies when, you know, a one-off happens. What happens when the fire occurs? How do we get in there with the technology? How do we get that data out to inform a better way forward and lower the risk? So without further ado, I believe we've got Chuck that's going to kick us off with talking about how to leverage and integrate those data sets that he was touching on a little bit to help inform the asset management approach at utilities. And then again, we're going to let these guys just kind of respond in kind. If Kerry hears something that's out of bounds, it's on him to fact check Chuck. If Jeff says his company can do something better than Chuck's, then it's on him to bring that up. And then over here, we've got Tom being the end user customer to say, hey, that's not practical, we're not implementing that, or I'd like to hear more. And I'll just kind of sit here and make sure that we stay on track. So Chuck?
Well, just to be clear, I don't compete with Jeff in any way. I'm not in the LiDAR acquisition or processing business or any remote sensing we manage.
I was just trying to tee up some controversy up here, Chuck.
Okay. That was my former life, when we may have been. So one of the things I'd like to, before we start the discussion, I'd like to ask in this room just a quick poll of the audience on three quick questions. The first is, how many represent a utility in this audience? It's a little hard to see. Okay, we have a fair number. How many have used remote sensing data in any form for their operations? Great, that's great. And how many would also say that they would like to have access to more remote sensing data as you go forward?
Two hands up.
I got two hands up there. That's great. You know, that is, I think that's part of the challenge is that we're trying to make it more accessible, right? The industry needs to figure out how to make it more accessible. And I said earlier with the Wildfire is the one example of how making that data available on a common platform would be really helpful. But I thought it'd be good to walk through an example here where if you're in the role where your utility manager had and your job is to, in this case, we'll walk through a use case here that maybe we can tie this together in a meaningful way. We've been asked to identify all the danger trees on our rights of way as a utility. So we need to understand where those danger trees are, specifically in the high fire risk areas. And then within that danger tree set, and the danger trees are all trees along the right-of-way, just for this definition for the conversation here, all the trees along the right-of-way that if they fell to the line would hit the line. So that's the definition we'll use for the danger tree. And then a hazard tree is a danger tree, one that would fall and hit the line, but actually has a defect, an obvious defect in it. So we'll use that as the next level of analysis. And what we're really trying to get to is those hazard trees have a higher probability of striking the line, causing a fire. So we want to address those as the highest priority, right? So how would we go about that? Well, the first step would be as a utility is to think about your network. And most utilities do have a geospatial shapefile of their network, so you can use that as an overlay. But then you can go out and find publicly available data. And that can be data from satellites. It can be two-dimensional, three-dimensional data. When I say three-dimensional, I refer to LiDAR data. But at different resolutions, high resolution or low resolution, there are a number of data sets out there that you know, somebody that knows where to look can find a lot of data for that purpose. And so you have that as background information, and you merge that with your infrastructure information. And then you would look at things like, because the first thing we're going to do is we want to figure out where my high fire threats are, medium and low. So the first part of this process will simply be to find high, medium, and low threat areas. And we can do that generally with publicly available data, so the cost is very low, relatively speaking. So let's go through that exercise. We can bring in two-dimensional data, again, imagery data for species. You can do some species differentiation between conifer and hardwood, for example, with infrared imagery. There are hyperspectral data sets out there. I think that's an emerging field. But generally speaking, there's a lot of infrared imagery and color imagery out there. And then in certain areas, there's higher definitions, like I mentioned in Sonoma County, of LiDAR data that you can use to model. So we're going to use that information, and we're going to identify those threat areas. That data can feed fire fuel models. You can use some of the work that's already been done by many of the agencies on fire threat conditions that exist out there. That's already been done, so you can merge that together. So now you've identified in your network specific, you can add your population densities, you can add your own internal drivers of areas of concern that may not be in the public data set, but you know about them because you manage this facility. So you come up with a risk profile of your network. And now, but what our objective of this exercise is to determine the danger trees. So far we haven't done that. We've only narrowed the area down. So if we have, say, 1,000 miles that we're trying to analyze, maybe we've been able to eliminate 500 miles because they're in low areas. They're across fields. They're in areas that don't have high fire threat potentials or even moderate fire threat potential. So we can eliminate those from our need. But we do need higher resolution data on the corridors around the high and medium threat areas. So now what we would do is think about constructing a remote sensing program where we might come in and bring in a UAS, a drone, if that's the right circumstance, or you can use a helicopter. Some cases you can use a fixed-wing aircraft to capture the data. And there's where you would get your fine-scale data, your current high-resolution, and I mean very high-resolution, LiDAR and imagery like you saw on the earlier presentation from Fugro. And that kind of data is what we're talking about. But how do you know where to collect that? And this is the process you might get to figuring out where would I need to do that on my network. So with that, you can collect LiDAR data, the imagery being ortho, downward, or nadir view imagery, and then oblique imagery looking forward if you're using a UAS or a helicopter. And that gives you sort of a human perspective of the landscape. Then the technology that's available for the analytics, you can fall digitally all those trees that failed and see which ones fail clearance. So you're creating that danger tree analysis with digitally falling the trees towards the line. You can actually sag and sway in the software. This is very common practice, so this is not anything new. But you identify which trees are your danger trees. So now we've identified on our network in our high fire threat areas, our danger tree areas, and now we want to look within that data set and find our hazard trees. So there's where you would turn to the infrared imagery, and you would start looking for defects, dead, dying, and alive. You can pretty easily classify with that technology. So now you've narrowed it down to your next level down, and then that information then can be sent to the field and become actionable information. So hopefully that sort of sets the stage for how we would take advantage of all this data, and it comes from many, many sources. It's not one size fits all. There is no single solution that's the right answer for every single problem in this industry. It just doesn't exist. It's really a stacking this technology together in the right order. And that's where I'd like to open the conversation from there.
Yeah, I'll sneak in one thing. If you followed that, and that was amazing, Chuck, that just to keep double-clicking down through to separate the signals from the noise. If you get all this data, but if you follow that through all the way down, he's pinpointing, number one, the risk location, then the risky trees, then doing the fall analysis, then figuring out which ones are going to fall first. That technology is available today. It's just being able to structure those data sets in a way that you understand them so you can get that end user impact. And what I was thinking while Chuck was talking, we had everybody raise their hand out there, who is the utility, who's using sensing data. I'd like to know who's using some of those publicly available data sources to inform on top of what they're collecting themselves. And just to put them on the spot, because that's the part we're in, we have one of those end users. So I'm going to actually turn to Tom and ask him whether or not they're doing that at SDG&E.
So for, like Chuck was saying, I think a lot of this is existing data that is out there. And finding the right pieces to put them together goes back to that whole data picture. And that's something that we've had difficulties with that Chuck and I talked about earlier in respects to, even if we're seeing or collecting this, be it by helicopter, be it by multispectral, whatever the source is, this data has become sort of, as it's been described, a data tsunami. And it's engulfed us. And how do you use it? When do you use it? Do you discount the old data? Is it in the right format? All these things sort of go together, and it sort of precedes every time we talk about things like this. We talk about data, and we talk about, hey, how are we actually using that data? So while we do some of these things, how we do them, and I a little bit out of my swim lane in respects to exactly what our vegetation management folks are using and how they're using it, it is still a data problem to us. And we've just recently started a program where we're starting to put everything in one spot, that data repository. We're putting it in the right spot. We're starting to set that stage for all those future buzzwords you hear out there of what can be done with that data. But as Chuck said, a lot of that can be done right now. So we're a little bit behind the ball in respects to here's what we need to do and here's what we need to do with that data. We're in a little bit better situation in San Diego just by knowing what areas we need to map, which areas we need to look at more intently. Hey, this is a fire-prone area. This is not a fire-prone area. Or this is a, you know, there's nothing there. These lines are running through the desert, and they're not, you know, the vegetation isn't an issue for us. So we have lined up our territory in that respect to understand where we need to go and when we need to go to that area. It's just a matter of making sure that we're taking the existing data, using that existing data properly. And that continues to be our challenge. And again, with all the existing technology that's out there, you'd think this would be a little easier to do. It's just you get overwhelmed real quick. And I would also add, what is the requirement? What does somebody need to know? You know, I mean, you could equate that to driving your car today. Do you need to know the temperature of the road surface, the asphalt temperature?
there are things out there that we don't need to know, but again, who is doing it now? What are they doing it with? And how can they say, hey, here's the requirement, here's what we need to know? And again, most of this is out there. It's just a matter of integrating it properly, using it properly, and getting it into the system so that we can actually have that actionable data.
Yeah, that's really well said, Tom. And the thing I picked up there at the end is that, you know, he mentioned that, you know, what's practical at the end of what his message was, too. It's like, instead of swinging for the fences, if everybody out there were to ask another question, I would assume 90% of the hands would go, if you've heard about machine learning and artificial intelligence on this data. Well, that stuff's there today. But a lot of the, you know, the executive groups we talk to, they're saying, oh, yeah, we need that. We need machine learning. We need artificial intelligence. We have to have that tomorrow. Then you explain to them, you know, the process that goes into that, and I'm certainly not a data scientist, but then they're like, oh, their eyes open up a little bit. But to Tom's point, you're not going to do machine learning on everything. We want to talk them through, what are your top 10 problems? Where's your real manual burden at in your data processing? Let's go about this a smart way. Let's use that machine learning or artificial intelligence to look at a broken cross arm or a broken avian cover, if that's something that is, you know, taking a lot of manual hours out of you, and we can subtract and be smart about it. So, Jeff, I'm going to go to you next. How would you, if Tom, you're going to talk to Tom about how to manage this data? I know you've got some thoughts there.
We've hit a roadblock, Matt. We've hit a roadblock. We haven't addressed the elephant in the room. How much is it going to cost? How much additional cost is this going to be to address these fallen trees? And this is what happens when we go into a utility with this data. We've been assessing transmission and distribution networks for about 20 years. And there's a very common theme that we've found, especially with vegetation, is in transmission networks, and typically for those that aren't in the sector, you basically plan your work well forward ahead. So in Australia, we have a 5-year regulatory cycle. So we know 5 years in advance how much we've got to spend. So you can't come up with a 200,000 new fallen trees or hazard trees that you've got to do work on. So the challenge is saying, with a transmission network, about 25% or less of that network will need some work over the next cycle. On a distribution network, it's about 65%. They're the numbers that we're seeing. So, and with a distribution network, you might have 50% of the trees within the corridor are fallen trees. So this is the next layer of thing that the utilities are wanting to know. Can you assign cost? Can you assign not only risk and how close and whether it's going to fall in? They want to know how much the program is. Because if you've only got limited funds, you need to be able to back off the work that you do and do the most important work first. So that's sort of the holy grail that we're working towards, is saying, how do we quantify the costs and then prioritise those risks within it?
Yep. Again, very well said. And that's, we're finally piling up enough data on what the ROIs of these technologies to be able to do some of that analysis. And we're hearing the same things. I'm hearing from some of our clients and from some of the conversations I've had with these gentlemen, you know, if I have $1 to spend, where am I going to stick it to lower my risk profile? And we're finally starting to get there to where we can perform that analysis and be smart about that. I think that's really well said. And I think you're right. That is the elephant in the room about the cost. Other clients we're talking to are saying, hey, does it make sense for us to partner with the vendors, or should we own a little bit of this technology ourselves? Like Tom mentioned, they're standing up, you know, they have their own program. They're going to acquire and own some of their technologies because they know there's ROI there. They might not scale and do their entire service territory with that technology. Might not be feasible. Maybe it is in a few years. I don't know. We're going to have to keep accumulating the data and perform the analysis, to Jeff's point. The second elephant in the room, I would say, at this point, is that, so we've talked about the data piece, and we kind of skipped over the collection a little bit. And so this is going to carry, because why Jeff is over in Australia with a lot of what he's doing, where we don't have to have the FAA rules. In order to get that data, we still have to get it compliantly. And I think it would be valuable for us to let Carrie touch on a little bit about how the FAA is viewing using these novel technologies to go and collect that data, what's being allowed, where we're sitting at with flying beyond visual line of sight to go up and down the corridors, et cetera, so that way we can accumulate this data, perform some of the analyses that these gentlemen are talking about. Carrie?
Yes. I would like to see a show of hands again from the people representing utility companies. Now, do all of you have drone operations as part of your inspections and surveys. Okay, so a decent amount. How many of you have run into problems with getting airspace authorizations depending on where the airports are? Not as many. What we try to do is we recognize that there's limitations to what you can do. If you're close to an airport, there are certain rules and regulations that you have to adhere to, and your drone program has to take that into account. Of your the people in the room, how many wish that they could get beyond visual line of sight authorizations for wide areas?
That has to be 100%.
And you've run into problems trying to get those from the normal FAA sources, correct? When most people in the FAA hear beyond visual line of sight, if it's not an emergency, their eyes roll back in the head and they just take out the no stamp. No, can't do that. One of the things that we recognize is that going forward, it's not practical to say every drone crew that you employ and goes out there can keep it within the line of sight. There's also limitations to beyond visual line of sight. So when we get called, we ask a lot of questions. Where is the location? We quickly map it out. We look to see where it's at. And we try to come up with something that will work for your crews as well as not impede air traffic in any way. Doesn't make sense to say, all right, I need to go and map around LA Airport. Can you guys go and shut it down for the next 4 hours for my crew? It's not going to go over too well. It'll be in the press. They'll call the FAA administrator, who will call up my group and yell at us. And my boss gets upset when he gets yelled at. So we don't want to do that. But there's a lot that we can do to help out. I know that there's a lot of utility companies across the country that have crews that go out there and they have local agreements with air traffic. I don't know if you're doing that here in California, but one of the things I would warn against that is if your crew doesn't have a paper authorization with a signature, then they're basically flying in the blind. And if something happens, it's going to come back to you. And I've talked to a lot of utility companies about risk management, and the last thing you need is for some type of a mishap and your insurance company says they're not going to pay because you didn't follow protocol and your crews did not have the proper authorizations. I work with the FAA. I know it's really easy for a local air traffic facility to give you a verbal on the phone. Sure, go out there and your crew can do whatever they want. If something happens, they're going to either forget that they said to do that or they're going to deny it. And it's just much easier to follow the process. If it's an emergency, you come to my group. Like I said before, we're 24/7. If we can't say yes, we figure out how to get you to yes. And with the fires of this past year, a lot of TFRs go up. A lot of drones have geofencing built in that they can't fly if there's a TFR. My group's the only one that can actually give authorization to get into the TFRs. So one of the things that I really hope to achieve by coming here and helping out and being part of this great panel is by sharing some information that you could take forward. A lot of you, if you don't have a drone program now, you will, because this is the future. For cost purposes, you have a crew that's out there flying drones that's cheaper than having a flight crew flying helicopters, and it's actually less risky to have manned aircraft rather than unmanned aircraft. And if there's anybody here representing the manned aircraft industry, I apologize. I'm not trying to take your job away from you. Just seeing the shape of the future and trying to go with the flow and helping everybody out.
Yep. Yeah, thanks, Gary. And we went to him strategically there because the next piece of this is going to be talking about responding to an event, an emergency. And so the theme here, you know, wildfire, right? So it's, you know, unfortunate incidents. And the thing that I want to make sure that's clear with what Gary's group is doing is we're all familiar with Part 107 and how difficult it is to get your beyond visual line of sight waivers and et cetera. Kerry, one thing he didn't touch on that I know he's doing actively today with his group is preparing for emergencies, so you don't have to wait until that event happens. And we're gonna talk about how we may approach that with the technology in a minute. But you can get with Kerry's group early on. In fact, he recommends it. Seeing him do this today, getting with utility companies to scope out what the response plan would be, because if you can get his group in the know of how you're going to react to an emergency, well, when he picks the phone up and you say, you know, if it's Tom at SDG&E and Kerry's very familiar with what his operations are, he knows that he's gonna, you know, stay below 400 feet, he's gonna stay out of Class D airspace, et cetera, he's not gonna have to shut down LAX or I guess Lindbergh in this case with Tom, well, Kerry's gonna say yes, and it's gonna go that much faster. So we're really encouraging folks and our clients to get in with these guys at the FAA because they wanna take the same steps you do, but of course, they have to obey the regulations. So I'd really recommend getting in touch with them early on to get safe operations up and running.
If I could just ask a question. I saw in the brochure that a representative from Florida Power and Light was gonna be here. Are they still in this room? No? I bring them up because Florida Power and Light has been utilizing drones specifically for the last couple of years for all their line surveys, all their pre-hurricane preparedness. And they ran into a situation recently where the FAA, a different office, not mine, had revoked all their jurisdictional COAs. And they had them for basically every airport on the east coast of Florida and some on the west coast that they deal with. And we noticed an uptick in requests late at night for the next day of dealing with transmission lines that were being identified as going to lead to a widespread outage. So they wanted to get the crews up there. And you utility folks probably know this. It's identified, and how do you quickly identify, get it out there, get the crews, and correct it? So I spoke with the representative from Florida Power and Light, and I asked him about their jurisdictional COAs, and they said they had been canceled. So I told him, send them to me, and he sent me 30 of them around every airport, and I extended them forward by a year. So in helping them in reducing the wait times, which time is money, that within a couple of weeks we identified their particular issue of maintaining their lines, and we extended their jurisdictional COAs. So if you go back to your crews, ask them about their jurisdictional COAs, because those probably all ended last September, and you're being told to use the automated process that's not 100% operational right now. There's a lot of problems, and we're trying to help out. And again, just one less thing that you have to worry about with everything else going on, that you don't want to be bogged down in unnecessary paperwork, unnecessary delays, and you want your crews out there taking, you know, pictures of the lines and maintaining awareness of what's going on. So I'll give it back to you.
Yeah, thanks, Gary. It was perfect, because we're gonna give each of these guys about a minute or a minute and a half to talk about, you know, if there is an event, and Kerry just talked about how you should be looking at his shop. Get in with them early, so that way they understand your operations are safe, so you're reducing your wait time to respond to that. So we'll give each of these, the remaining three gentlemen, a minute or a minute and a half to talk about how they are viewing, you know, responding to that event from their seats. I think we'll take Tom first as the customer and saying, you know, I think it's logical. We understand what the regulator is saying. If Tom's got an incident, you know, what's important to him? How is he getting out there to assess that? And then we'll look to Chuck and Jeff to talk about how to leverage the data to be a little bit smarter when they're going into that unfortunate situation. Tom?
You bet. Most of the incidences or events, if you will, in San Diego are, you know, wind-driven fire-type events. But again, we have to open that up to any of the possibilities of what could happen there. And having that relationship with the FAA, we started that early on. We understand where they're coming from. We've worked with them throughout. I think that regardless of where you are in your UAS program, it needs to be done. It needs to be started. day one, because that's ultimately where we're going. And I think sometimes we hear or we read a media report and it's like, oh, the FAA is doing this and they're not on board with this or what it might be. And you realize that, well, what you're trying to do is probably pretty dangerous anyway. Building that proper program and having the proper regulatory efforts behind you just help you out when the emergency does come. I don't think we're surprised by anything that aviation-wise comes up, because we always look at every kind of hazard, and even a regulatory hazard might be out there for us flying our UASs, flying our helicopters, whatever it might be, especially around the incident. If you got a TFR set up there, do we even need to fly? Are we requested to fly? Is there something with our infrastructure? Keep in mind, we're a utility. We're not the firefighters. We're not the we're not the ones going out there to help put out the fire. We're adding assets to it. We have a wonderful piece with the air crane that we offer up to Cal Fire, which is usually one of the I'll call it a weapon that's going out there to put out that fire. But we aren't the firefighters. We turn that responsibility over. Again, the firefighters who know how to fight that fire are the ones out there. For us to just say, hey, we're going to go throw a drone in the middle of this, isn't realistic. So for us to ask, we would expect the answer to be no. But again, that coordination between the incident commander, between our crews, hey, what exactly are we going to do? And is it going to be in the TFR? Is it going to be outside of the TFR? We'll cross that bridge when we get there. But having that relationship, understanding what you need to do when the incident comes, there's a lot of this stuff can be done well prior to an incident ever occurring. So with any kind of UAS program, having those policies, procedures in place, and ready to react to what you need to once that incident takes place is really important.
Yep. Yeah. So the key point I think takeaway there is get in early with your regulators, get the coordination tight between the two individuals on my immediate left, put yourself in Tom's seat, talk to Kerry. So now we've got our coordination done. We're going to be able to fly in the emergency. We're going to be able to respond to it. Tom knows where all his assets are going. Now we'll look at Chuck and Jeff to tell us a little bit about how we can leverage some of those integrated data sets to get rapid results and information that the end user can use during the time of an event. So Chuck, Jeff? Whoever, sorry,
sure, I'll cut in out of sequence here. I think what was interesting in Chuck talking about where the LiDAR industry was at a number of years ago was desktop software, modelling software. It was long turnaround time. So now the next generation of technology is basically cloud processing-based technology. So you've seen Tony demonstrated Roams. You'll see San demonstrate the EnView offering. So the technology stacks now are becoming very sophisticated. So our tech stack works off the Amazon platform. So we're leveraging that processing power, cloud-based processing, to be able to turn data around quicker. So when you're responding to issues like this, that's the next generation of LiDAR processing that we're starting to see. So the data's turned around and the goal is to get it near real time. So admittedly, I think we're still a little way from that. But in reality, that's not too far down the track. So we're leveraging platforms that are already there. We're moving away from the old desktop version. So it's I think that's the next wave of where we're seeing the industry go in this space.
I'll just add to that point. I think you're right. The technology, again, it's not about technology. It's about how do we bring it together in a meaningful way. And just to make a point for people that aren't deep in this space, LiDAR is really good at measuring things, but it's an unintelligent sensor. You have to have human intelligence, or in our case, we a lot of times, the industry uses imagery to supplement. So let the LiDAR do its measurements where you need measurement data, but then the imagery needs to be at a resolution and a quality that you can actually make, humans can view the imagery and make decisions. So the generation of software that's coming out now really brings that forward. Cloud-based applications where you can collect the data somewhere, other part of the world, literally, and have trained inspectors looking at that data to make informed decisions about actions. So you can have experts, vegetation management experts, fire experts, or what have you, looking at this data almost in real time. That's really where the industry, that's another step forward in the industry in terms of situational awareness and managing these data sets.
Yep, yeah, very, very well said. So I think just to summarize here, coordination between the end user and the regulatory body is key. And if I could summarize what Jeff and Chuck said, access to timely data that's high enough quality to actually make an impact in time of event is going to be critical. And those technologies are available today to get there. But I'm just going to quote Chuck. It's all about being understanding how to put those together. And there's a lot there. You've got to figure out how to unpack everything that's out there and figure out what's right for you in your specific situation. So we're coming up on 5 minutes, which I want to leave for questions, but we got just enough time to give each of these gentlemen 30 seconds for a closing statement. So if you guys want to leave the audience with one thing from today, we'll go right in order down the line, Tom, Kerry, Chuck, Jeff, and then we'll take some questions from you guys. Tom?
I should have sat in a different seat. So I think from a UAS program view, having the foundation to me has always been key. And again, I'll go back to nothing should surprise you. You should anticipate everything that you need to do, have the proper operators out there, have them have a training program that these folks can go out there and actually use the UAS properly and fly around the wires in a utilities case, fly around where, you know, a lot of people don't have a lot of practice, but setting that up properly, setting up the program right from the ground up will pay dividends as you get into the bigger picture type LIDAR collection, multispectral collection, whatever you might be doing with those UASs.
And just continuing on with the UASs, my group particularly, it's not the only thing we do, but we were brought in to help the communities, to help the United States, really everybody in it, when there's emergencies, to help first responders. That was job number one. Bring them in, get them what they need, get them in the air. We've worked through all the hurricanes, through all the fires, and it's just going to grow going forward. And I could tell you that my group will always be there. We are going to expand. We are going to be the number one source for helping you get in the air when you have to, whenever there's some type of disaster. And we'd rather that they never happen, but they happen. And we're always going to be there to help.
So my comments would be around addressing the elephant in the room on costs that was raised earlier. And anybody that works in the utility industry knows that there are a lot of silos in the industry, and I think that's one of the fundamental changes that needs to occur when you're thinking about remote sensing, high scale or fine scale remote sensing on your project, is to think cross-functionally. Think about the other users who might benefit from that data. Asset inspection is a big use case that has tremendous value. Beyond just identifying the danger trees we did in our example, vegetation management has many other use cases. Engineering have use cases right away, environmental use cases. Those are things, if you stack them together in the right way, you can actually collect the data. That allows you to collect the right data, the right resolution, to get more value across your enterprise. So think holistically. That would be my advice around addressing that elephant in the room, the cost piece, because it's real.
And on a similar theme, don't let technology be a hammer looking for a nail. So make sure it's not a solution looking for a problem. So if you're a utility, please tell vendors about what you're actually trying to achieve. Not a specification on the data. So tell us about the use case, the problems that you're seeing on your network. So use vendors out there as capability partners, not just providers of a service. So that would be my, and it fits in with Chuck's sort of integration, you know, comment.
Yep, I'll just try to tie that together really quickly. And if I'm going to wear their hats walking down the line here, well, I think what Tom is saying is prepare. That's the word I heard. Prepare early on, often you're going to be better served. Kerry's word would be coordinate. Coordinate with your regulars early on. You're going to get value out of that. and then acquire the expertise from gentlemen like sitting at the end. If you need it, reach out. Get what you need. They're the folks that are out there doing it a lot. We know a lot of you at the utilities are very busy. These gentlemen are doing this every day. They can inform you on that cost-benefit analysis, LiDAR technologies, the sensors, the flight, et cetera. So hopefully they'll let us buy a couple minutes. We're at 2 minutes now. We're going to take your questions. But before we do, if everybody give a round of applause to these guys for traveling out here. Appreciate that. So, all right. Number one. Right here in the front. Yep. I don't know if we have mic runners or out there or I can give you mine if you just want to. Here.
Right. In the interest of time, I'll just grab it from you. Thank you. My question is on the relationship between aerial patrols and using technology and people. How much of this strategy is to replace, or should be to replace, people with drones doing human patrols with the drones, and where is the future relationship of using aerial patrols and data and analytics, and what should still be left for people? Thank you.
That's not the first time I've heard that question. So to summarize, a lot of new technology out there that's going to automate. Are we going to replace the human beings? Are we going to go to the age of the Jetsons?
Right. We've all seen Terminator, right? We know Skynet's coming.
Yeah, the Skynet conversation. I think that first and foremost, I'd probably turn that one to Tom and say, you know, what kind of impacts has the technology had at your company?
Especially on the first part of that question, we're always looking more towards the efficiency side, and in respect to maybe that the supervisor is doing maybe remote ops, the 107 operator is with the drone's flying over the pole set while somebody sitting at their desktop can say, okay, I see roughly what each one of these poles is going to need. So when the truck's rolled out to that particular pole set, they have the tools they need. Taking, again, miles off the road, but making it more efficient for that group to go out there and actually work on that particular pole set. So I think initially it's more of an efficiency type thing. You can jump to the conclusion that yes, it's going to affect people, but I think that's down the road, and I think it affects them more in how they're doing their work and where they're actually going to be located. You know, maybe they become the ones that are operating the drone or whatever it might be. But I think it's just a shifting of where the responsibilities are and more of an efficiency type thing rather than a replacement type thing.
Yep, we've seen the same. We've actually seen it create jobs in a lot of cases. Just the skill sets are shifting. So we're over time. And Dan, are we allowed to buy a couple minutes up here for other questions, or do we got to cut it? Got it. Yep, we certainly don't want to be the people that keep you between you and your meal. So, I mean, we're going to be accessible after the panel, so we'll let you guys go get lunch and feel free to attack us when you're getting sandwiches. Thanks.